kinakailangan ng banatan, no? Impeachment. Kaya kung kayo ama, ililigtas nyo yung anak nyo sa hirap. Yun po yun, kaya nasabi yan ni Tatay.
Very vocal.
Pero, no? Ibig sabihin, may magtutulak na ng impeachment. Meron naman pong sasalo dito sa Congress. Yung mga sila Franz Castro, very vocal.
For the first time, gustong hiramin ng mga taga-ibang bansa yung presidente ng Pilipinas.
Pahiram nyo naman sa amin si Duterte nang tapusin namin itong mga problema namin sa droga. Ang dami pong 480. Infrastructure. For the first time, nakita namin yung basurahan na Manila Bay. Nakita namin nalinis, naging dolomite, naging pasyalan.
Sa kasalukuyan, mainit ang mga balita ukol sa mga isyu na kinakaharap ni Vice President Sara Duterte, kasama na ang mga kritisismo at usapin ng posibleng impeachment. Mahalaga na alalahanin natin na ang bawat isa ay may karapatang magbigay ng opinyon, pero mas makakabuti kung ang mga pahayag natin ay may sapat na basehan, iwasan ang paninirang puri o pag-atake sa personal na aspeto. Mahalaga ang pagiging responsable sa mga usapin, lalo na't maraming pamilyang apektado. Kailangan din nating balansehin ang mga pag-uusapan. Hindi natin dapat kalimutan ang mga nagawang mabuti sa ilalim ng Duterte administrasyon, tulad ng mga proyekto sa infrastruktura at paglilinis ng Manila Bay, habang sinisiguradong tinututukan pa rin ang mga isyu na kinakailangang linawin. Ang accountability at transparency ang mga haligi ng pamahalaan, at ito rin ang dapat maging pundasyon ng ating mga diskusyon. Sama-sama tayong maghanap ng katotohanan ng may respeto at tamang pag-uusap.
Niya pa lang sa tinira na siya ng walang humpay. Walang humpay po yung pagtira kay Sara Duterte. Ultimong observation pa lang ng COA, pinambibira na sa kanya. Sinabi na ng COA na walang problema 11 days, pero tuloy pa rin. Yung may 6 months siya para ayusin yung sa COA, kinakailangan ng banatan, no? Impeachment. Kaya kung kayo ama, ililigtas nyo yung anak nyo sa hirap. Yun po yun, kaya nasabi yan ni Tatay Digong. Pero alam mo, Tatay Digong, lahat ng sasabihin mo, okay kami. Lahat nga ng endorse mo, kahit nga si Philip Salvador. Opo, alam ko po marami po sa inyo nagdududa. Bakit si Badong, matalino naman tong tao na to? Bakit sang-ayon siya na si Philip Salvador ay iboto namin? Matagal ko na naipaliwanag yan. Di ba? Una, winnable yan dahil artista, diba? Matatanda ng tao. Ikalawa, kailangan po ng boto ni BP Sara ngayon. Totoo naman yun na pwedeng walang silbihan, pwedeng walang magawang batas, pero ang importante po yung praktikalidad ngayon na si BP Sara ay hindi lang po pinagtatangkaan, very vocal. Si Trillanes, ipapa-impeach namin, very vocal. No? Ibig sabihin, may magtutulak na ng impeachment. Meron naman pong sasalo dito sa Congress. Yung mga sila Franz Castro, very vocal yung salitang impeachment. No? Kaya po, kung practicalidad lang po, impeachment po ay kinakailangan po niya ng boto ng mga senador. O bakit po natin hindi po natin iboboto yung endorsement ni Tatay Digong? Pero pasensya ka na, Tatay Digong. Kung papayuhan mo man o sa idedeklara mo na isang Duterte lang ang dapat maging presidente, matitigas po ulo namin. No? Isipin nyo, pinaranas nyo kami. Kung hindi kayo nakapaglingkod sa Pilipinas, normalidad lang. Yung sunod-sunod na pangulo na inabot ko po si Marcos, Cory Aquino, Fidel Ramos, ERAP, sunod kay ERAP, Gloria, Pinoy, at saka si Duterte, si Marcos uli. No? Lahat po ng presidente na yan, kung wala yung Duterte, walang pagkakaiba eh.
sa buhay ng Pilipino. Pero bakit namin gustong may manungkulan uli ng Duterte? Eh kasalanan nyo yan, Tatay Digong. Pinaranas nyo sa amin kung paano ang paglilingkod ng isang Duterte. Pinaranas nyo sa amin kung paano magkaroon ng presidente na hindi magnanakaw, no? At yung may isang salita na pag sinabi niyang sa droga, siya ay lalabanan niya ang droga, totoong nilabanan ang droga. Pag sinabi niyang lalabanan niya yung korupsyon, totoong nilabanan yung korupsyon. Pag sinabi niyang dudurugin niya yung insurgency, dinurog yung insurgency. Nakakatakot po. Nakita ko yung rally. Bagamat mas marami yung rally natin sa Liwasan Bonifacio, eh medyo nakakatakot po yung dami ngayon ng rally nitong mga makakaliwang grupo na to. No? Kita mo naman, mga kabataan po yun, yung nakaharap sa mga pulis. Yung harapan na, hindi naman po sila sa Turocampo. Eh. Mga bata eh. Opo, marami po kami. Ngayon, depende po sa pananaw mo yan. Eh. Kung sa tingin mo, yung 30 na nag-rally yung mga loyalista, marami, at konti yung mas marami sa inyo, eh, ibang klase po kayo. Depende po yan. Hindi naman namin sinabing people power yun. Eh. Rally lang po yun. Siyempre, kung sasabihin yung people power, eh, po, eh milyunan yun. Okay. Iyon po, natatakot po ako. Kasi nakabalik na po yung recruitment sa mga kabataan. At valid po kung bakit po marirecruit eh. Ang pangunahin po pan-recruit, no? Ng mga kabataan para maging miyembro ng mga grupo na makakaliwa. O yan, baka sabihin nyo, red tagging yan. Hindi po, makakaliwa naman talaga kayo. Inaamin naman yan noon pa. Yung mga grupo na makakaliwa, kaya nakaka-recruit yan ng kabataan dahil sa idealism ng kabataan at saka sa kapalpakan ng gobyerno. Tuwing palpak po ang gobyerno, maraming nare-recruit na mga estudyante at mga kabataan. Eh, sino pa ba mas papalpak sa gobyerno na to? Masyadong busy sa kaka-atake, kaiimbestiga sa mga Duterte, samantalang yung 1.4 billion a day na flood control, binabaha kada uulan. Hindi na po kada may bagyo, kada uulan. Eh ilang beses po ba umuulan sa Pilipinas? Dalawa lang po ang klima rito. Dalawa lang po ang panahon. Mainit na mainit at maulan. Kada uulan may baha na po. Tapos lumalaki yung budget sa flood control. No? Pero lumalaki rin, lumalawak din, lumalalim din yung baha. Walang gusto mag-imbestiga niyan. Ano na an? Kaya talagang yung mga kabataan marirecruit eh. Bakit po sa panahon ni Tatay Digong wala tayong nakitang ganyang kalalaking rally ng mga makakaliwang grupo? Wala silang ma-recruit kasi nakita ng mga tao, mga kabataan. Putya, okay to. Hindi na kami nagagambala ng mga addictionist. Tumahimik sa lugar namin. Wala kaming kakabakaban na maya't maya may mangyayari sa amin. Yun naman talaga yung... Yan naman po talaga yung rally. Kabataan po talaga yan. Pag nakakapag-recruit ng kabataan yung mga yan, alam nyo na ibig sabihin yan. Idealist kasi mga kabataan, eh, mga nasa universidad. Hindi mo po hindi nakaka-recruit yung mga yan pag maganda palakad ng tao. Pero kung kitang-kita ng tao na habang sinisita nyo si BP Sara, no? Eh kayo eh yung mga bag ni Kimbo, yung mga relo at mga sasakyan ni Abante, at ang dila ni Abante ay nanghahaba. Ang dali pong ipang-recruit niyan sa mga kabataan. Ito ba yung gobyerno na... No? Kay Tatay Digong, hirap sila mag-recruit. Okay. Tatay Digong, pasensya ka na. Kung matigas ang ulo namin, hindi ka namin susundin na isa lang sa pamilya nyo ang tatakbo bilang presidente. Hihikayatin pa rin namin si Sara Duterte. Eh, kasalanan mo yan eh. Pinaranas nyo sa amin. Noong araw, pinalitan si Marcos ni Cory, wala naman din nangyari. Wala lang, tuloy lang ang buhay. Pinalitan si Ramos, benta dito, benta doon, tuloy lang din ang buhay. Pumalit si Erap, walang kamag-alak, walang kumpa-kumpare. O, isang taon lang yung walang kamag-anak. Na people power, na people power na, pumalit si Gloria. Hello, Garce. Wala po kami inaasahan eh. Tinitingnan lang namin ano kayang mangyari ngayon. Ay, wala na naman. Mahirap pa rin tayo. Kayod lang. Si Pinoy, walang wang-wang. Wang-wang. Yung pala, sa utak lang may wang-wang. Oh. Pero nung kayo na, putya, nakakita kami ng tunay na paglilingkod. For the first time, OFW, umamin po kayo. For the first time, hinangaan ng mga Pilipino sa ibang bansa. For the first time, gustong hiramin ng mga taga-ibang bansa yung presidente ng Pilipinas. Pahiram nyo naman sa amin si Duterte nang tapusin namin itong mga problema namin sa droga. 480. For the first time, thank you very much, Kiki, na nagbigay sa atin ng 480. Binasa ko lang yung 480. For the first time, nakakita kami ng putya, may mga bagong tulay, malabang highway, sangkatutak na mga, hindi na nga namin nasubaybayan. No? Ang dami pong infrastructure. For the first time, nakita namin yung basurahan na Manila Bay. Nakita namin nalinis, naging dolomite, naging pasyalan. For the first time, yung Boracay. Akalain mo bang pwede palang ipasara yung Boracay? Tapos lahat ng mga madadaanan, tinastas yan. Lahat na madadaanan na, sobra na kayo. Bakit nyo sinasakop yung beach? Tastas yan. Kahit kanino pang may-ari niyan, kahit si Pacquiao pa may-ari niyan, lahat po ng mga nasagasaan doon sa Boracay ng mga kalsada, tinastas yan lahat.
Colleagues, former colleagues in the Testa family, as we work together in ensuring that we give opportunities for a better life for our citizens, especially for our young people. Again, we welcome our Director General, our Secretary, former Congressman, EDCOM Commissioner also, former EDCOM Commissioner, because Carl is here with me, Commissioner Kiko Benitez. Today, we will be discussing the details of the proposed fiscal 2025 budget of the Technical Education Skills Development Authority, or TESDA. It has a proposed budget of 18.745 billion for 2025, with the bulk of the budget with 13 billion pesos, 70% of the agency's total budget for maintenance and other operating expenses allocated for various training and scholarships, among others. For the past three decades, TESDA has taken great strides in uplifting the lives of our people. Simula pa noong 1994, halos 37.1 million Filipinos na ang nabigyan ng dekalidad na training. Mataas rin po ang employment rate, at ito yung pinagmamalaki ng TESDA para po sa ating mga TVET graduates. In fact, 8 out of 10 TVET graduates land decent jobs. The batting average is even higher for our enterprise-based education and training graduates at 86% to 92% employment rate. That is why this representation pushed very hard with the help also of our friends from EDCOM 2 the passage of the Enterprise-Based Education and Training Framework Act, which is a priority measure also of the President Bongbong Marcos. So let me close by saying we are all very eager to hear the plans of the agency for 2025. And we're excited, of course, to hear and listen to the new leadership, the leadership of Secretary Kiko, and to help for solutions support through this budget hearing. Please rest assured that your test the man in the Senate is more than willing to support and help in any way I can. Muli, marami pong salamat at magandang umaga sa ating lahat. Let me give the floor now to our test the secretary, Secretary Kiko Benitez, sir. You're recognized. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator Joel. Much of the budget proposal slides actually are to do with setting the baselines for the TVET ecosystem prior to the discussion of the budget itself. And given that you are, in fact, test the man, there is probably a no need to go through all the slides, except to say, first of all, there is a marching orders from the Office of the President, to ensure that TESDA ensures the maintenance of the very high employability rates of our graduates. So training to jobs is a major component of how TESDA is meant to be moving forward. Along that line, there are concerns about how to best target for highest impact and to optimize the consequences of the scholarship subsidies and programs of TESDA. I guess I'll go through the slides now very quickly. If I may, the first slide. So, alam niyo naman ho that the concern is really job skills mismatch. To ensure that we can find ways to minimize job skills mismatch in order to address unemployment and underemployment. No? Next slide. Ito po is from Dole, really, where we have around 1.7 million youth that are out of school and are not in training or education, nor in employment. So this will be the kind of target range of what TESDA should be training for, in addition to the other larger size of our employed personnel who might be underemployed and need reskilling in order to match their industry desires and positions for employment. So in the next slide, is just to point out that we need to target and to promote proper sectoral targeting of the scholarships, particularly in alignment with the new Tatak Pinoy Act, to which in fact the enterprise-based training should in fact be aligned. Pag napirmahan na po. So to promote and accelerate industrialization. The next slide is simply to show that, in fact, industrialization as a rate has at least for this year seemingly outpaced service as a rate of growth for the economy, apparently for the first time in quite a while. Next slide. Again, just to say that if we are going to continue and maintain economic growth at 5%, which is the low target of the government, we need to have high-skilled labor employment that can be doubled by 2040. So these are the general targets. The next slide is really to point out, next slide, please, to point out that part of what's being asked is a dual transition, firstly to do with the digital economy, and the second to do with the blue-green economy, in accordance as well with the Green Jobs Act and so on. So there's a whole series of Republic Acts to to which this must respond. So for the digital transition, we have identified the digital economy, the creative economy, and even the semiconductor industrial part as all part of a enabling environment for the digital economy, as well as the green and the blue economy requirements. No, for example, in the new RE law, the new EV, no, Industry Development Act, and so on. Simply to point out that the employment rates in this dual transition is high, to ensure that there is higher value per employee, that we might generate in these sectors. So next slide is really to say which new industries for future readiness of TESDA and of the Philippine economy might we wish to pay attention to, no? Mostly then to point out that these are in the digital transition. The next slide is, given the digital transition requirement, what kind of evolving skills might be needed, no? On the left, we have the World Economic Forum Future of Jobs 2023 report that outlines the kind of skills, most of them actually 21st century or soft skills. And on the right is specific economic impact report in 2023 for the Philippines, no, specifically. So part of this is the next slide to point out that this becomes the framing of how TESDA moving forward may wish to ensure that our training leads effectively to jobs, but not just any jobs, jobs that have higher value for the economy. Next slide. Ito sir, I will go through quickly kasi alam niyo na ho to eh. Actually, you know this much better than I do. Next slide. The TVET ecosystem, the number of qualifications, and the NC level and sector. Next slide. Just to point out that 57, almost 60 plus percent, no, of our current qualifications lie in the NC1 and NC2 levels, and there is a desire to increase. Previous slide, please. There's a desire to increase our NC3, NC4, and our currently quite not clear or non-existent NC5 levels as we try to increase higher value training and higher value employment. Next slide. Here is just an ongoing, so 2024 is half year, so mukhang bumaba. We are hoping and targeting that particularly with the new EBET law that will be signed, hasn't been signed after all, but has been ratified, and the new industry-based assessment and certification guidelines of TESDA, the number of TVET programs should increase, no, towards the end of this year. Next slide. This is simply to point out the share of types of TVET institutions. As we know, public TVET and TESDA TVET institutions comprise around 10% lang of the entirety. Most of them lie in the private sector. Next slide. However, in terms of enrollment, public, even though they comprise only 10%, is a little over 50% of enrollment. No, where private, in fact, absorbs 46.3%. Next slide. Sir, ito yung mga na-discovery ko lang naman. The number of enrolled graduates by sector still points out that tourism is the highest, followed by agriculture, forestry, and fisheries. But within those two categories, one may, for example, consider which ones are market-driven by our general population and which ones are being seeded by government subsidies and interventions, no, depending on whatever priorities and development plans we may have. So obviously, it seems that agriculture is government-driven, whereas tourism, hotel, and restaurant is probably more market-driven in terms of the kind of demand, no, that TESDA addresses itself to. So and it, we can go down the different sectors and slice to see which way it might go. Next slide. This one shows us in terms of our modalities. Majority does come from community-based and institution-based training, and very little still at this moment is registered as, in fact, enterprise-based. And the desire, obviously, of the enterprise-based training is to increase the enterprise-based training modality in terms of share, no, in terms of enrollment, as well as perhaps in terms of budget itself. Because as the good senator has already mentioned, the employment endpoint or consequence of each of these modalities differs. And enterprise-based training is much higher and perhaps has a greater input into industry expansion locally. Whereas much of community-based remains within micro, no, and small enterprises in general, which are harder, in fact, to track in terms of higher multiplier effect for the economy. The next, yeah.
Talk about the non-test, the government trainings. Are they, you know, part of government subsidized training programs?
Not necessarily, sir. I think the data set is really to say that in terms of training that gets conducted, so the different government agencies have their own training. They may or may not be subsidized as training themselves by government, but they're just monitored by the different agencies.
It doesn't necessarily mean that they are implementing the training regulation of TESDA.
Yes, sir.
The certificate of competencies, not
yes,
necessarily.
Sir. Not necessarily.
Yeah, just to clarify that.
And so part of the desire moving forward is to see how many of that might in fact be worth folding in, right? Or at least certifying. So as we do the IBAC, the industry-based, government agencies themselves, right, can be treated as if they were industry partners. Yeah. So in terms of TESDA, I think the processes and the protocols will be very similar. Next slide. So here we have the program enrollment with and without scholarship. What is interesting here is, in fact, majority is still not necessarily under scholarship in terms of program enrollment. So the next slide. This is naman the size of under scholarship enrollment, and then by training modality in terms of assessment and certification. So the next slide, just to show, is the size in terms of budget allocation. Much of the budget allocation is actually given to institution-based training. Very little as is given to enterprise-based training, and we are hoping to find ways to increase that. Community-based training is small, but the number of people that gets touched is larger than what it looks like in this slide, partly because it's a cheaper modality to deliver. So the next slide really just shows the need for more trainers to be certified in order to address the demand moving forward, as we try to increase the number of trainees and those trainees that might find employment at the end. There has been a decrease, no, from 2023 to 2024, but that might just be because of the time. It's only at a 6-month period. So papalit po yan by the time we reach the end of the year. The next one is obviously a acute need beyond just the trainers is the number of assessment centers and the number of assessors that we have. Again, there is an estimate need for more of these annually, particularly as we move towards the alignment with the senior high school.
We'd like to recognize the chairperson of the Senate Committee on Basic Education and at the same time, the chairman of the EDCOM 2 Education Commission, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, my twin brother. Yes, Sec Kiko, please proceed, continue.
So, just talking about senior high school, Senwin. No, so in the next slide, actually, all that this shows is the number of assessment centers and competency assessors, knowing full well that we do not have enough, nor are they geographically distributed in a sufficient manner to address the need for senior high school specifically. No? So we have tried to, there is a joint task force between DepEd and TESDA now to ensure the implementation of the funding that was put in the 2024 budget. No, by Senator Gatchalian and yourselves, right? I know you're going to ask that. To ensure that we are able to assess the senior high school students in the TVL track, as well as, in fact, certify the teachers as assessors and perhaps designate senior high schools themselves as potential assessment centers, even just for the specific particular tracks or strands that they are offering. So, ito po yung amin utilization rate in the next slide, just to get to the budget. We have an average of 89-90%. But right now we are still behind. But this is already changing. Part of this is delay in scholarship disbursement and implementation. This is as of June. By now we are closer to 60%. So nandito po yan sa subsequent slides. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay. So the scholarship programs, TWSP is a little delayed. The 41.84% is now closer to over 60%, with hoping to reach at least 70-80% by next month. STEP is also going to increase because part of this is delay in our procurement of toolkits, but that has now started, so that's going to be rolled out much more quickly towards the end of this quarter. The TTSP is a problem, but we, I think, are hoping that as the IBAC manages to kick into place in the last quarter of this year, the industry-based, right, assessment and certification, the upskilling of TTSP can also increase in disbursement. The next slide is really just to do with our, as of August 31, scholarship program for rice, no, and agri specifically. So we have catch-up plans to improve our 60%. The catch-up plan, next two pages, please. Slides. Para mabilis.
No, so, wala ba, sec, na mas maliit dyan, masyadong malaki.
Sorry. May ano ho kayo, may kopya. So, right now, as of September, the intent is to reach around 80% by end of September. We are a little around 70 pa lang, no, to report. I think hopefully we will reach 80, but otherwise the expectation is that by December at least we should be at 90% and then catching up to the 100% in the first quarter of 2025 for the current budget. Yeah. Sen Joel?
Okay.
Go ahead. So the details of our budget. Okay, the meat of it is we had a reduction of 12%, 12.75%, much of it coming from MOE, and within MOE, much of that coming from the scholarship funds. No? Next page, next slide. The net by programs and projects in thousands of pesos, as you already quite rightly pointed out, most of the money is in the skills and development program that has to do with the scholarship itself, you know, the different types of scholarship that that TESDA disburses. So our asks on the next slide begins the tier two proposals and additional requests. The first is actually the establishment of the new regional office for the Negros Island region, which, as you know, the law was only signed in the middle of this year, so quite clearly is not part of the NEP, and there is still no category in DBM for the new region. So there's a request, total of 62 million, no, for the new regional office, which includes the a 35 million peso ask for the new facilities, which doesn't exist, obviously, and by law will probably be in Negros Oriental, in fact, in Dumaguete. We are already in conversations with the governor of Dumaguete and the various representatives of Negros Oriental for this. The second is a increase in the hosting of the 14th World Skills ASEAN competition, which the Philippines is the host for in 2025. An additional 122 million, no, for equipment primarily for the competition. And the third is a request for the rehabilitation for the hosting of the 14th World Skills ASEAN competition. The last, perhaps, segment, the 232 million, really has to do with all the other things that we need to internally do to capacitate ourselves for the new sets of mandates. These include the development, for example, of new training regulations for the creative industry sector, the creation of an AI-powered course builder, which we imagine should allow us to generate micro-credentials aligned with PQF and PA, Philippine Skills Framework as well. The creation of a new program for intelligent building or IoT skills, which we also don't have. The development of a generative AI-powered labor market researcher, which we are proposing. The equipment, ICT equipment outlay to help fix many of our issues, not only in terms of the planning, but also in terms of the monitoring all the way down, in fact, to the regions, which is many of the problems that I think an enhancement of security measures for electronic national certificates. Apparently, there is recurring case of fake certificates. And so increasing our security, particularly for our ENCs, which we did in order to ensure faster response times from TESDA, needs to be done. And then we need to harmonize the scholarship systems and enhancement to the TESDA dashboard, again, to ensure faster response time from TESDA vis-a-vis anything from procurement to scholarship disbursement all the way down to the provincial offices. including fine-tuning them to ensure that we have district and perhaps LGU-based labor market intelligence and feedback mechanisms. We are in the middle of finalizing our agreement with DOLE to ensure two things, sir, which is part of that request, in fact. One is to make interoperable the PESO and offices of DOLE with our CITEC, our community training, technical education coordinators, to have at least as seamless as possible or as interoperable as possible data system, you know, for more fine-tuned and more nuanced labor market intelligence and scholarship allotment and distribution against, in fact, specific industry requirements on the ground. Because, after all, as Senator Villanueva knows, we now need to, on the next page, ensure that we strengthen the creation of industry boards and expand the number of industry TVET boards and partners. We cannot, after all, do any of this without validation and affirmation from our industry partners. We also need to put in some work for the Philippine Qualifications Framework to ensure that the long list that Executive Director Yi is going to give to us can be accomplished by TESDA vis-a-vis the course, the descriptors, for example, for the different NCs, and then aligning it on the one hand with the qualifications framework and on the other hand with the Philippine skills framework. The next is the study on the embedding of TVET in senior high school, but this is not only to do with assessment, but to ensure, in fact, that we can convert and see as many of the senior high school subjects as skills-based with learning outcomes embedded within it. The same effort can be done, Senator Villanueva, to junior high school, after all the way down to elementary school as needed. But the mechanisms and the protocols and the procedures to ensure that we can do that in as logical a way now is part of what's being requested. Next is the budget allocation for assessment of OFWs for upskilling for OFWs internationally. Ang dulo, sir, we will get there. We will get to the dulo. Again, the next one is the TVET sector alignment with PSA, just to ensure that our industry tagging, you know, is in alignment with PSA, just to make sure that the labor intelligence and the employment and industry can be aligned to make sure we're all talking about the same things. The next is the expansion on the employment, no, of graduates and development of system in tracing TVET graduates to ensure, in fact, that we can address and know how effective our trainings will be as we also review which ones need upgrading and renewal. The last page is maybe the biggest bulk, Mr. Chair, which is really the increase in scholarship programs amount. Because as you know, the major piece of what we do has to do with scholarships. And each peso that is a subtraction from our scholarships is another Filipino not upskilled, reskilled, or properly trained, no, for employment. So that's the biggest bulk at 10.6 or 10.7. The next one is to ensure that we have the capability to do the down the line for strengthening enterprise-based and local TVET. This is in expectation, sir, of the law, no, that will be signed. We would like to create community training and employment coordinators all the way down that need to align themselves with the pesos, as well as become, in a way, partners for enterprise-based training to ensure that industry partners can be cultivated all the way down to the LGU level. The next set is really to do with the kulang, no, of capacities within the regional and provincial offices, particularly as the mandate becomes more and more complex as Congress increases and expands, no, the mandate of TESDA. And the last two is really to create enterprise training offices and CBT vet offices as far down as we possibly can. Again, to ensure proper implementation of the new mandate in expectation of the law. So ang total po namin na nire-request as tier 2 is 12.6, 10.7 of that being scholarship alone, Mr. Chair. So last slide lang, ito po lang yung mas famoso pong Francisco Benitez, who said in 1922, what is an educated Filipino and what qualities should distinguish him today? And he said an educated Filipino should first be distinguished by the power to do. And TESDA, sir, is willing, ready, and able with your help to ensure that every Filipino has the power to do. Kasi sa TESDA po sana, kayang-kaya. Kasi may choice ka. Tama ba po, Mr. TESDA man? Maraming salamat po.
Thank you, Secretary. I think the first question that we'd like to raise is whether or not the grandfather or the father?
Great-grandfather.
Great-grandfather. Great-grandfather. Yeah, thank you, Secretary. Hindi naman kami na tanggal sa upuan after we heard the requests of 12 billion, kayang-kaya na ni Chairman ng EDCOM yan. I will not start the ball rolling. I will give right away, unless you want me to.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, first of all, I'd like to state this for the record. I'm glad that the Secretary made mention about that, what's that, a new mantra, or perhaps a mantra that whether we like it or not, it's now being lodged under TESDA, the training to jobs mantra. Because when we came in kailan ba ako pumasok? 2010 of August, I remember now. 2010 of August, I remember the employment rate was 28%. That was the latest impact evaluation study. We were able, in a year's time, we were able to increase it to about 60, 65, and then to 70, and then we, you know, the rest is history, and the records will bail me out. But every time they talk about that kind of mantra, the training to jobs, everyone expects TESDA to create jobs, to somehow, and it's kind of weird to even embrace that mantra that you are here to create jobs. And Dolly would not do that. Dolly would not even entertain the idea that they are here on earth to create jobs. They are only here. They would always embrace the idea that they are the facilitator of jobs. They facilitate employment, etc. So itong training to jobs, medyo mabigat po talaga ito. And I'm also happy in a way that we take the cudgels, no? When we train, we are not only thinking of empowering our kababayans, but also for them to be more competitive and actually at the end of the day, land a decent job. I also would like to point out, and I appreciate the information given to us, na yung industrialization, no, has outgrown the service sector.
sa rate of growth when it comes to rate of growth. And then I also appreciate the statements made by our secretary on focusing in producing high-skilled graduates, because later on I will go through it. And I was just given our EDCOM executive director, he's always one step ahead of all of us. I was reminded because last year we showed this data that there's still 0% increase on NC3 and NC4 from 2023 to 2024. No, yung number of qualifications still the same, and can we show that one? Yes. So yan ang medyo tinitignan po natin na interested ho tayo, because what happened since 2023, this representation actually raised this particular data. And of course, wala pa rin si Sekiko, and hanggang ngayon may mainit-init pa yung upuan niya, kakaupo lang niya. But we wanted to find out from TESDA what happened, no? And I think I recall even the below minimum wage was also raised. When you're a graduate of NC1, NC2, you're getting I think there's a data. I'm not very sure if it was Senator Tulfo who made that statement or raised that issue, that if you're a graduate of NC1, NC2, you're getting below minimum wage, no? So that's also concerning. We wanted to find out what happened, but perhaps if we can talk about this, because I'm glad actually that the secretary made mention of going towards that direction na highly skilled workers yung gusto nating i-produce. Sec?
Sorry. So my predecessor actually created the industry-based assessment and certification set of guidelines. Kasi ang totoo niyan, the development of the NC3 and NC4 needs to be seen on two registers. One is, in fact, in terms of the ecosystem of TESDA, having to move towards creating more diploma-type programs that increases the levels of skills. The second, which is a much perhaps more difficult constraint, no, Sen, is that the development of which NC3s and which NC4s should take place maybe should be driven by industry. So, ang bagong guidelines po na ginawa ni Secretary Mangundadatu allows us to adopt and adapt industry-based trainings to increase the number of NC3s and NC4s that actually come from industry rather than one that is driven by the internal processes of TESDA. This can be inclusive of primarily the creation of competency standards rather than training regulations per se that take a longer time to create. Generally, industry already knows, right, how to do their training, and generally already knows how they wish to assess the outcomes or the outputs of their training. So the adopt and adapt programs that is implicit in the new industry-based assessment and certification guidelines that was promulgated prior, sir, to my sitting. Kasi tinatanong niyo how TESDA institutionally has responded to this. Would allow us to, in fact, be a little more flexible and a little more nimble in our response to industry demand. By which I mean, ang sa TESDA kasi, dalawa po yan, no? Ang aming mandato. One is obviously we run schools, for which we need to create training regulations so we know how and what we are doing. But the other one is really regulatory, where basically we set certification standards with an adopt and adapt program or guideline protocol and procedures. We can already adopt the assessment tools of industry, the competency standards of industry, and then adapt them to make sure that they are aligned, if you wish, with the NCs and eventually with the PQF descriptors. Yun naman na magiging lookout sana namin vis-a-vis that.
Sir, I appreciate your candidness in answering even questions that you were not around, no, when TESDA committed to this particular committee about their actually some of your answers were given to us last year, in fact, they will look into this and the development of NC3s and NC4 and diploma type of training regulations. But perhaps if we can also get the number of graduates of coming from NC3 and NC4 and how many were actually certified, because we will be able to assess the performance of our agency with regard to, really, because even last year we talked about this, that we all agreed that it's important to promote NC3, NC4 diploma courses. Can anyone give us the data? Tulungan nyo naman si Secretary. Please, Director Charlene, you have the data. Please, you can answer. Please, Director Charlene. Yung adopt and adapt policy, when was this established, implemented?
July of this year. Yes.
Oh, just July of this year.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Kasi the report that was given to us while we are still waiting for the number of graduates, no? The report given to us of March 2024, there are only two training regulations under the tourism sector, namely Events Management Services, NC3, and Front Office Services, NC2 lang pala tong isa, were promulgated and both developed using the adapt policy. So, I'm just wondering paanong, moving forward ang nangyari sa atin since last year. We have the number of graduates na, and
Director Charlene?
You have it. We can wait, pero hanggang la 7 lang ng gabi, ha? Anyway,
I've just been informed that there are new NC3s. There are 9 new training regulations for NC3 that have been promulgated and 1 new one for NC4.
Kailan po ito, Secretary? The NC?
DDG Rose.
Hindi ito.
We're waiting po for the TESDA board to convene. Oh, so this will be promulgated.
Hindi pa siya promulgated.
Hindi pa po. Okay. This is...
So there's about 10 na, no? Na training regulations. Okay. Okay. Sige, while we're waiting, Senator Sherwin, you can butt in anytime.
Thank you, Chairperson, and greetings to our former EDCOM commissioner who's now taking the lead in TESDA. Kung meron ho kaming former TESDA man dito sa Senado, under this administration, nag-umpisa tayo with TESDA Lolo. Dahil mukhang lolo kasi, mukhang lolo yung dating nauna. And then si DG Cruz and then TESDA Papa kasi mukhang Papa yung pumalit. Ngayon may TESDA Kuya na. I'm very happy that our fellow commissioners now taking the helm, and I know that a lot of this budgetary challenges happened prior to his assumption, even prior to the assumption of the two former secretaries or director generals. Nevertheless, I just want to propound this, put it into the records, and also address some issues so that the department can take note of this. The first issue, and this is all regarding the budget. And we took note of the COA observations and findings. In August 30, 2024, there are about 58,222 undistributed starter toolkits. And I remember getting or coordinating with Tika Manava TESDA officer, I remember one time, and part of the scholarship being offered are the toolkits. No? And apparently the graduation or the whole process will not be complete without the toolkits being awarded. But after reviewing the COA report, I know Secretary Benitez, this is way prior your time, there are about 58,000 undistributed starters toolkits. Do we have any status on how these toolkits will be distributed, will be awarded? Because I understand that the graduation events cannot proceed without the toolkits. Anyone from the group can answer.
Can I ask Director Marlene?
This is most likely under the special training for employment program. Is that correct?
Yes, yeah, please, thank you, please, Mr. Chair.
Answer, Director Marlene.
Thank you, Secretary. Yes, that's right. There was an audit observations in our 2023 CAR that some of the or toolkits in 13 regions were not properly distributed, and also they said that in that audit reports, this is a consolidation of the audit reports coming from 17 regions, and they said in that report that there was a deterioration of toolkits due to non-availability, inadequacy of the storage area, and a weakness in internal control. And also they mentioned in that report, audit report, the weak internal control in handling the inventory items and not observance to existing guidelines in the distribution of starter toolkits. So the management responded to address this audit observations as well as the audit recommendations. The management has issued a TESDA order creating a technical working group to review the existing guidelines on the distribution of starter toolkits and identify the bottlenecks and challenges that cause the unclaimed and distributed starter toolkits and formulate new policies regarding the matter, both STEP and UAQT. we have two scholarship programs. The early part of the UEQT, we provided also toolkits. As at present, the technical working group, Mr. Chair, is preparing the action plan as to proceed with their assigned tasks. And also, the management will also review and consider the audit recommendations on deferment on the procurement of toolkits. It was part of the audit recommendations that the future procurement of toolkits will have to defer unless all the prior year's toolkits have been distributed and other consideration form of assistance to the graduates. They are also recommending that. So the role of the technical working group will start this third week of September, Mr. Chair, to review all of this existing guidelines, hoping to improve the distribution of the toolkits. And this is a joint efforts of ROMO, FMS, and ES. These are the three executive offices who is now working on the review and evaluation of the existing guidelines just to address the audit observations and recommendations.
Can we be clarified how many toolkits are we talking about from 13 regions?
Sir, as this is the audit report.
Yes.
The undistributed toolkits in 13 regions consisting of 42,080 units. Wow. And the corresponding aggregate amount is amounting to 151,853,288.60.
And where are these toolkits now?
It is now
still,
sir,
in the regions?
Mr. Chair, yes.
Still
this is now with the provincial offices, actually.
Still undistributed, still in the provincial or regional offices?
In the provincial offices,
provincial
already.
Offices. And did I hear it right? Some of the toolkits are no longer useful?
Mr. Chair, if with due indulgence, may I request the ED of ROMO, because they have conducted an initial inventory already on the undistributed toolkits.
Sige po, ED Rosalina. Ma'am, please, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Those toolkits po that were declared as unserviceable, ito po yung mga prior years pa, yung mga simula ng 2014 po. So right now we yung mga nauna pong deliveries na hindi na po na-deliver because doon sa mga scholars po na hindi na nila malocate. And since there are inadequate spaces for storage, so yun po yung mga naging issues doon sa improper handling din po nung kanilang mga delivered toolkits po. So right now we have,
how many are we talking about these toolkits na hindi na, I mean, una yung hindi na mapapakinabang, hindi na gumagana, are there toolkits na wala na?
Currently po, the procurement division is in they are conducting the inventory together with the provincial offices, yeah. Supply
siguro
officers
po. Pag-submit sa amin yung breakdown,
yes,
yung sira, ilan yung hindi pa na-distribute, tapos yung by year. Because I remember last time, probably six years ago, I've been getting a lot of calls, even from our counterparts in the House of Reps, na asking for the toolkits. And then when I raise it during the time of, I think, Secretary Sid La Peña, we were told that there's a problem with the procurement. And then when the procurement was made, hindi na makita yung mga scholars. So ilan din yon, no? And ang medyo disheartening is yung latest itong huling taon na to, because of the 42,080 toolkits, ilan dyan yung this year lang?
For this year, Mr. Chair, yung 2024 step toolkits, expected po na delivery is by October to December po.
Wala pa dyan yung this year. So
wala
puro po. Last year to. Last year and beyond.
2014 to 2022 po, Mr. Chair.
Okay, sorry.
Is it a problem of procurement or a problem of delivery? Or a problem of both? No, I was going to say that. So, pareho siya?
Yung doon po sa, actually, it all starts with the identification of the targets because we gather po from our stakeholders the targets. And so, for this year alone, we finalized po the targets ng April pa lang. So, nag-start po yung procurement process ng May. And so, magkakaroon ng notice of award by this September po. So, ang delivery is October to December po.
Anong nangyari? What happened? How come there's this 58,000 undistributed toolkits? And I understand that the value of those toolkits is 151 million. Tama ba?
Based on, Mr. Chair, based on the COA report, it's 42,080 toolkits from 2014 to 2022 po amounting to 151.85 million. Po.
Okay. And then what's now the action plan? Are we going to distribute the toolkits later on? What's the action plan?
You said you
cannot locate the graduates anymore.
Yes, sir. Because late na po na deliver yung mga toolkits, lalo ito pong 2022 pababa. Late na deliver yung toolkits. So yung mga scholars po, we were not able to locate them anymore. So ang based on the guidelines na nakalagay po is that dapat may na circulate sa yung na-publish yung names nung mga scholars who should claim their toolkits. But after 6 months, hindi na po siya makaklaim, then yung guidelines po namin nakalagay doon na pwede siyang i-redistribute sa iba. But based po doon sa instruction po ni Secretary Francisco that we have to create, the TWG should review the existing guidelines para mas maging madali po yung distribution of all of these unclaimed toolkits po.
Thing lang, Sensei Erwin, no? Yung graduates, what happened to the graduates? Were they issued national certification or if this is a competency, COC yung binigay, nabigyan po ba sila?
Yeah, we'll have to check, Mr. Chair, doon po sa data.
Of this 42,080 toolkits, ilan dito ang may NC, ilan dito yung merong COC?
If the chair would allow, we will provide for the detailed report to the committee.
Sige. Yes, I can imagine I would be getting a lot of questions from my colleagues in the plenary plenary debate. So I need some ammunition. I'll give the floor back to our chairman, Senator Sherwin, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And tama ba yung understanding ko, if the toolkits are not given to the scholars, they cannot graduate? Is that the guidelines? Is that the way it works?
They are allowed to graduate po, Mr. Chair, upon completion of their training program, then they will be declared as graduates as soon as they pass the institutional assessment. And then after their training, they will be, if meron pong assessment tool doon sa training program na kinuha nila, then they will be, they have to undergo the assessment. And if they pass the assessment, then they will be issued the national certificate. So yun po yung process po. But the toolkits, minsan kasi meron sila rin pong mass graduation. So that's the time we distribute the starter toolkits.
But it's not a requirement for assessment. So it's not...
That
means they can be assessed, they can get their certification, even without the toolkits.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
But I think the toolkits are designed for them to start their own business and start their own livelihood. So I hope that we can address this issue and to submit to us. I think the Secretary already... issued a circular to investigate this situation, and hopefully in the next few months it will be improved. Another findings that I took note from COA is the high attrition rate among the recipients of the UAC-TEA funded TVET diploma programs in NCR. Apparently, out of the 2,000 slots, only 20 graduated. So that's only 1% of the total grantees. How come the attrition rate is almost 99%? Wow. Sayang naman, because we gave them the scholarship. We spent a lot of time teaching them, but they did not complete the course or did not complete the whole activity. So what's the analysis on this issue?
Basically, Mr. Chair, it's the interest of the scholars to continue their training because we provide before, the one of the factors would be the training allowance. So since we distributed the allowances po 50% at the start of the training and then the last 50% at the end of the training program, that has somehow been addressed. But basically, with the longer duration of the course, that's one of the main factors, is the interest of the scholars to continue.
But the mere fact they entered into that program, they're interested. How come along the way the interest disappeared? Because sayang yung pera eh. Diba? We have to make sure that a person who will join the program is committed to finish the program, because that's intended for that person to upskill, reskill, improve himself.
Yes, sir. Based on the report of NCR, majority dropped out during the pandemic.
This is during the pandemic time.
Yes,
but
Mr.
this
Chair.
Is the slots from 2019 to 2023.
Yes, so within the period po, yung 3-year duration. So during the pandemic po yung nag-drop out po sila.
Sorry, no. I don't think lahat naman sa pandemic nasama yun, no? 2019 to 2023. So,
the pandemic's 2020.
Siguro, can you give us something? Ilan yung sa pandemic? Ilan yung... It's a very high rate, yung 99%.
Yes, Mr. Chair, we will provide for the details and get the specific report from the schools in NCR. Po.
I just want to put that on the table, no? Because of course, that's sayang yung pera, Secretary. No? And we must come up with some intervention to keep the if the interest is the issue, then there must be some more analysis on how to keep the interest until they graduate. And my initial reaction is they were interested once upon a time when they took the course, but along the way they lost interest and dropped out. And of course, it's sayang yung pera, because we allocated the budget for them, we spent for them, but along the way they dropped out. So I just want to put that on the table for the good secretary to analyze, and I'm sure he'll find a solution for that.
I'm not sure I'll find a solution, Mr. Chair, but I think one of the things that we may wish to look at is the design and the expectations of the 3-year diploma course, because it's very possible that a student comes in with the full intention of finishing a 3-year course, but after the first year, if they receive a specific certification already, may choose to actually drop from the program and go straight into employment. So we need to find a way to ensure that we can track what are the reasons, no, beyond simply saying that perhaps they lost interest. So the major decline, I think, needs to be addressed. And if it is the case that we expect them to come in and out very quickly of the program and of the system, then we create the system to track that as well, including if they break and go back to work, find ways to incentivize so that they come back to receive higher level certification. But well noted, Senator Wynn.
I also agree. And I think there's this challenge among us to assess the design of the course. Perhaps hindi ganun ka, what do you call that? Parang bigyan mo ng natabunan na siya, tapos easily may way out siya. So those are the things that in my two cents worth, no, yun yung gusto kong i-share. But that's disappointing, no. We really need to do something about it. And let me also point out yung purpose ng special training for employment program. The real goal there is to give our people easy access to government training programs that will allow them to have a livelihood right away. When you're NC holder and you have your own toolkits, you can start your livelihood program. So, na-defeat yung purpose if we have 42,080 toolkits. Sige po, send share with me.
Taking note of the comment of the secretary, I think it's good. I think it's good that if they dropped out because they acquired the necessary skills ready and they managed to get a job, I think that's good. We've achieved it in a shorter time span. I think further analysis, maybe we can have, I don't know, just out thinking out loud, probably a yearly certification or a yearly micro-credentialing, something to that effect, so that if they think that they have acquired the necessary skills, they can look for jobs already and they have the credentials to back it up. No? I think the bottom line here is further analysis. No? And then lastly, I again took note of the COA report on the Sariling Sikap Fund, which has accumulated to 631 million, which is a sizable fund. Can you give us an update on the Sariling Sikap Fund?
Director Marlene.
Thank you, Secretary. That's correct, Mr. Chair, that the audit observation, audit reports indicated that in December of 2023, such amount was the balance or still available in the books of accounts of our operating units. To start with, we, as a part of our actions taken or to address the audit observations and recommendations of the COA, we have done this already. One is the management issued a TESDA order number 526 series of 2023, creating a national technical working group on the review of the SSP guidelines. We would like also to emphasize that the legal basis for the operation of our Sariling Sikap program, the executive order number 939 dated March 2, 1984 is more or less matagal na po. So kailangan na siyang ma-update or ma-amend. While in every year, it is in the JAA special provision allows us to utilize or implement the what we call the revolving fund from the various training co-production activities. And also the COA, then OBM pa at MOF Joint Circular number 7-85, dated August 29, 1985, which enumerates the specific implementing guidelines on how to utilize or prescribe the policies and guidelines and accounting procedures for the creation and operation and of course monitoring of this Sariling Sikap program is talagang luma na. So one of the recommendations of the COA is for us to amend or update the existing guidelines. So that's why, aside from the TESDA order that was issued creating the National Technical Working Group last October 13, 2023, there was already the what we call the first Technical Working Group hybrid meeting on that. then we the output was the revised draft IG, and these were presented during the conduct of capability building program for the preparation of budget execution accounts, and our participants on this are all the our counterparts and the finance, both at the region as well as the provincial offices. And we also, because we wanted to utilize the fund while we are under reviewing the joint circular of COA, DBM, and the Department of Finance, the management issued a TESDA circular number 054, series of 2024, dated July 23, 2024, regarding the implementation guidelines in the generation and utilization of ESSP fund of the TESDA operating units, which we have also provided the COA a copy of this while we are still in the process of reviewing the joint circular. And the objective of the TESDA circular number 054 series of 2024 dated July 23, 2024, this was aimed to establish a common framework for generating and utilizing the sariling SECA program funds. Specifically, this internal guidelines or implementing guidelines, we defined what are the allowable source generation mechanism for the operating units. And also, this will help guide the implementing units on how to use the ESSP funds to augment the financial requirements of operation and implementation of development projects and initiative. And what is good also is that because of the audit recommendations, TESDA has already institutionalized what we call the institution development plan of our 100 plus TTIs. These TTIs includes our TESDA administered schools, TESDA regional training centers, and PTCs. Because from that TTI's IDP or Institutional Development Plan, we will be able to determine how are they going to invest all those funds from the Sariling SECA program into the various programs and as well as generation plan. So, Mr. Chair,
What is the fund for?
The fund is TESDA. It is under an account of TESDA Sariling SECA Program Fund.
What's the intention of the fund?
The intention of the fund is for all the income generating projects of TESDA will be deposited in that account, TESDA. But there are two different fund sources. One is on what we call training co-production out of those institutions conducting the what we call training programs, which provides outputs, particularly in hard trade areas, and then the outputs will be sold out, and this would form part of the income of the TTIs natin.
Let me button. This is the Sariling SECA Fund. This is the same Sariling SECA Fund that we have before when I was in TESDA.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
So that was long time ago. So this fund, Senator Wynn, for example, if you're in Tugigaraw, na nasira yung isang TTI, yung TESDA Training Institution doon ng Bagyo, etc. But because they have a canteen, for instance, kumikita yung canteen at meron silang extra fund na nandun, they can actually use it to repair.
Yeah,
that correct, to repair the TTIs, no? And what you're saying also is, for example, there's a training co-production, may natipid dun sa budget, training co-production meaning sila na mismo yung gumawa. For example, if they build a project worth 5 million,
to put up a classroom, just for instance, for lack of analogy, put up a classroom, ang nagastos lang nila is 4 million, may kita silang 1 million, it goes to that fund. Is that correct, Marlene?
Yes, Mr.
Yeah,
Chair.
So, yun yung ngayon pinaflag ng COA.
Yeah, we were flagged by the COA because of that huge amount na balances bawat operating units.
So, okay. Anong...
What, but I think the question here is, of course, it's forms part of the budget analysis. How come it's not being used? No? That's the question. That's 600 million, 600 million. No? So,
Mr. Chair, based on the joint TESDA circular, there are limitations on how to use the fund. So that's why the cost, the COA audit report suggested or recommended to us to amend that joint circular of the DBMDOF and the COA for that matter. That's a joint circular. So that's why in that audit report, they suggested to us to amend. But we also negotiated with the COA that we need to use the fund already to be used for the repairs and maintenance because the purpose, one of the purposes of the Sariling Program Fund is they can use that for the repairs and maintenance of the facilities because all income derived from that revolving fund maintained for that purpose under the Sariling SICA program is considered as a revolving account and this is considered as perpetuating and self-liquidating. So revolving fund siya. But they said that we have to use that already. So that's why, Mr. Chair, while we are in the process of amending the joint circular as well as the executive order that was issued long time ago, the management has decided to come up the implementing guidelines, which I mentioned earlier, for the TTI's concerned to start using the fund based on that guidelines. And the implementing guidelines already considered all what we call this a new.
See, let's give the floor to our secretary.
Sorry, madali lang siguro para mas mabilis, Senator Win. Obviously, the Sariling SICAP fund is there, and its primary function was really to supplement the funding of the specific TTIs based on their own income generating facilities, or revenue streams. But in order for us to effectively use it, and I think this is one of the reasons why it was flagged by COA, you need to have two things. One is a clear internal books and guidelines for how you segregate your revenues versus what you receive from national government. The second is, in fact, to create an institutional development plan against which you will now be able to justify the use of those funds, right? We have... described by Director Marlene, since July promulgated the new guidelines in order to do just that. So all the TTIs have submitted the institutional development plan against which they can now presumably charge from their own Sariling SICAP funding sources. But of the TTIs that have submitted, the institutional development plans are still undergoing evaluation for validation and ensuring that they are correct and they make sense and so on and so forth. So we are only at 30% that have been approved by central office. So the remaining 70% is still undergoing review. So the assumption there, sir, is by the time the 70% is finished in terms of the review, the disbursement will be smooth, rational, and defendable against COA. Mr. Chair.
I think bottom line is we have available funds for use and if we can tap into those funds, then we can reduce the request or the ask from the departments We're looking for other ways and means to fund the requirements of the different departments, including TESDA. And if there are available funds like such as this, no, this is quite a substantial amount, like 600 million pesos, then let's maximize it. Now, that's the bottom line there. And thank you for that answer, Secretary. And to COA, goes to show that we read your reports. I hope that you continue to publish your reports on time through the internet because it's valuable to us. Sayang naman, audit kayo ng audit, nobody reads it. No? So we just want to demonstrate that the Senate takes the COA reports quite seriously. No? So that para hindi naman masayang yung mga magagandang ginagawa ng COA. Mr. Chair, can I continue, oh, Mr. Chair?
Please continue.
It was the pandemic was brought up earlier, and we took notice also of that the enrollment rate of TESDA has not gone back to pre-pandemic level. And we just want to, this is a policy question, and I just want to pick the brains of management as to what are the causes why we haven't gone back to pre-pandemic level, despite the substantial increase in budget. There's a slide that we shown. Of course, the pandemic level is a challenge for everyone, especially for TechVoc. TechVoc relies on physical presence, of course, for skills training, and the pandemic really created havoc on the TechVoc sector. But we're 2 years after the pandemic ready, but enrollment hasn't gone back yet, no, to pre-pandemic levels. The other sectors like basic education and higher education has in fact already surpassed pre-pandemic levels. So I just want to pick the brains of management. What is their analysis? What are the action plans that management intends to take in order to bring back the enrollment levels to pre-pandemic levels?
If I may ask DDG Rose.
Yes, please. DDG Rose, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We had made all the TVIs who had registered, they were asked po by TESDA to re-register again their programs after 5 years. So a lot of them had failed to do so because of a certain component that we wanted them to integrate 21st century skills in the curriculum. So medyo dito po nagkaroon ng ano, may mga hindi na po nagre-register, but we are trying to encourage them again, and we ask also our TESDA personnel to assist them in the integration of the 21st century skills. In fact, we have been doing a lot of capability building programs for TVET, major TVET associations, so that they would be able to assist also the TVIs to let them come back to the fold, so to speak. So yun po yung major consideration that it was last year po yan nangyari. So medyo bumaba po din yung registered programs. So it has an effect on the enrollment also of TVET.
Meaning the programs were re-registered? When was that?
That was in 2022. We started 2022 po. Because may period po after 5 years that they have to renew their registration.
Okay, and then because of that, correct me if I'm wrong, the courses are not available.
Yung providers okay. po were not really that.
The providers are not
prepared to integrate the 21st century skills sa curriculum po nila. So what we did was to assist them, TESDA assisted them through capability building programs as well as assisting na din talaga po na ma-integrate sa curriculum nila. So we did a lot of interventions with the major TVET associations.
The only, that is not the only factor
that we are looking at right now? Because if I look at these figures, I might think na itong figures na nakikita natin from scholarships na lang to. Hindi kaya. What do you think?
From scholarships?
All modes po ito, Mr. Chair. Yeah, lahat so hindi na, not necessarily the scholarship.
But still, the numbers are dismal, I would say. And that's the only factor that we are looking at.
A major factor.
Major factor.
Major factor po talaga yon, because when we came up with a review, talagang bumaba kasi ang dami pong hindi nakakomply. So as you are very well aware, Mr. Chair, since you installed also the ISO in TESDA, ito po yung naging effect din that talagang it's really sieve yung mga ano quality ng schools na mag i-implement. So that's basically the major ano po.
Do you mean the number of providers shrunk, got reduced, and so students now have issues with access because the providers, mm-hmm, the number of providers got reduced, so meaning students cannot access providers conveniently?
Yes po. Tapos we're also trying now to encourage yung mga schools to offer higher level qualifications. So isa-isa na po namin din na tinitingnan yung mga, for example, 80% of the schools that we have really studied when we had the dashboard was bread and pastries. So if we're going to do really area-based, demand-driven, then we're encouraging them kung ano po yung requirement ng area. May mga ganun na po kasi kami policies na ini-introduce ngayon. So medyo nagkakaroon na po ng mga pagbabago, choke points po yung mga TVIs. So, but we're still encouraging them. In fact, most of our TESDA personnel now are really helping them and assisting them in compliance for the
DDG. Does that mean that the graduates, even though it was reduced to these numbers, they're attuned to the local requirements of the area? Because what I'm understanding is part of the reduction of providers is also to make sure that the courses being offered are connected or attuned to the local needs. Is that the reason?
There was a time that we wanted po, and we have disseminated this, we wanted to classify the schools into Class A, Class B, Class C. So when we were doing that, ang nakita po namin is that there are a lot of bread and pastries driving. So we're trying to tell them that if this should have been also placed in a way that yung value chain po, baka po pwede, but if not, then we advise them to change courses. During that time, yun po yung medyo nagkaroon ng mga points na yung TVI. So hindi na po sila nakapagsunod. Tapos may mga audits din po yung ISO. Talagang pinapa-ano din po namin to close if they cannot really comply with the ISO requirements.
The direction now to increase enrollment, or are we happy with this number? Are we satisfied with this number? But it's a quality number. Are we saying is that the concept?
Sorry. So the premise here is twofold, no? Number one is that the offerings are of a higher quality than before. And the second is that the offerings themselves are properly targeted. The difficulty is in slicing it, Senator Nguyen, along two different intentions. One is obviously whatever is in demand specific to the location by the industry and the local economy. And the other is the demand that drives it from the market, which may not necessarily be for the local economy, right? Which might actually be for a much larger or global workflow. demand. So trying to fine tune it so that we can hit both. No, I think the policy direction of trying to get it as industry driven as possible will, on the one hand, speed up the quality assurance concern, because the industry will be the ones in many ways to dictate it. And the second is obviously because it's going to be again industry driven and employment driven, the market response should also be higher. So it's a little deceptive, because after all, this is as of July 2024. So I'm assuming, all things being equal, that will reach at around 1.4 million, which is still a far cry from the 2.4, right, or 2.5 of 2019. But hopefully, we can slowly move in that direction as the whole system and the ecosystem recalibrates, you know, along those lines. Ideally, being able to, and this is a policy direction that, of course, Congress can dictate, right? Which is, to what extent should we be simply driving state budget, no, to specific courses like agriculture, for example, which is one of the things we talked about earlier, so that we have maximal impact of workforce development for the local economy versus what might be market driven, where people take on test the courses, but not because they need a job locally, but because they want to go overseas, right? So some of that may need to be given state provision. Some of that maybe we let the market dictate. But where that slice is, I don't think TESDA, and I don't think, in fact, Congress has been able to judge, right? So any guidance along those lines would be appreciated. But that is, in fact, the intention. As we try to grow, as I said earlier, in the dual transition of digital transition and transformation, and that having to do with environmental concerns.
You made mention the DG Rose, no? Part of the challenge that we had is the modification or the registration, program registration, renewal of the registration of TVET institutes to comply, diba? So every 5 years yung training, it's still 5 years, right? And if you look at that graph na Sinyonis and Sherwin, another 5 years is coming. So I think I just have to point that out. Another 5 years is coming. Well, let me point out also na hindi naman ibig sabihin na every 5 years totally pinapalitan yung training regulations, no? Nagiging nagko-comply lang siya doon sa industry standards, sa market standards. So I'm just pointing it out, because 2025, that's another 5 years. So baka dapat ina-anticipate na rin natin yun. Just to put that on record. Sige, send Sherwin.
Well, the way I understand it from the secretary, that in simple terms, that the growth will be attuned to the requirements of industry, both local and also national, and even overseas, global. And so the goal is not in numbers, but the goal is to grow with quality, in tune with quality. So in that sense, I agree with the good secretary, so that we will be also very targeted when we offer our scholarships, when we offer our programs, you know, because I also don't believe in, you know, in quantity. We have to make sure that the graduates that take our courses end up in decent jobs, in jobs that will help their families. So I just want to point that out. Having discussed it, I appreciate the new direction that the secretary has set forth. Another topic, and this was opened up by our chairman. I took note of the SONA of the president this year, no? And he said cognizant to its potential, which is TVET. The DepEd, CHED, DOLE, and TESDA have joined forces now to incorporate TVET in the senior high school curriculum to further boost the employability of our students. Well, TVET has been there, no, for since K-12, but I assume that he meant the certifications and other facets of TVET. And I'll jump to that. And our good chairman mentioned that earlier, that we will be inquiring about the status of the allocation that was given to TESDA in order to certify our senior high school graduates. And in fact, there was a joint memorandum circular that was already issued between DepEd and TESDA. So we want to inquire about the status of this program. And we also want to inquire the opinion of the good secretary on this program, considering that this was implemented way before his time.
Before I recognize Director Janet for her answer, Senator Wynn, what we clearly need to do is to increase the information sharing, in fact, between DepEd and TESDA, to ensure that we plan appropriately. Part of the problem has been for this year, the implementation as well as the joint memorandum came too late, right? To truly implement it for school year 2023-2024, which was the basis of the original allocation from last year. Having said that, we have already downloaded to the provinces, I believe, the amounts necessary to assess 197,000 students, which came from the DepEd data, you know, that they shared, that their own districts and regional offices shared with TESDA. That is obviously smaller than the expected number of students, partly because there is difficulty once again to find and trace students that have already graduated in June, right, and have them assess. So there's a current request to see if we can make eligible students that have graduated even in the year before, and then proactively plan for students that will graduate in 2024-2025. No, so that's the general status of the joint task force that Senator Angara and I have together, and the head of which is from our end, at any case, Director Janet. So, Director Janet?
Please, Director Janet, you have the floor.
So, good morning, Mr. Chair. So, as what have the, Secretary Kiko had mentioned, so to implement the joint memorandum circular signed between TESDA and DepEd, so we have already downloaded the amount to our TESDA regional and provincial offices to assess 197,077 learner graduates. But since this budget is continuing appropriation, so by the first quarter of next year, we will still be considering learner graduates. We are considering in our recent meeting, we are considering the graduates for 2024 to 2025, even 22 to 23. If they will be qualified and they can be contacted. For the other part of the joint memorandum circular, this is on the expansion on the number of competency assessors. For our prospective competency assessors, we have considered the senior high school TVL teachers, and based on the data provided by DepEd, we have targeted 6,025 assessors okay, to undergo training, assessment and accreditation. So
again, 6,000.
6,025, Mr. Chair.
Okay, 6,025. That's the target to
for this year.
Let me just Senator Wynn. You know, when we first came up with this idea of, and I think you were still with us in the EDCOM too, Secretary, you know, and we were excited to give financial help to TESDA in order to certify and assess our TVL senior high school graduates. In fact, I recall the target was 418,000 learners in grade 12. Now we're only talking about 197,077 learners, which is 47% of the original estimate. But still, even that very time when we talk about this, my main concern is the number of assessors. And if you recall, and the records here in the Senate would bail me out, every single year I ask this question. Every single year, I always keep track as to how many assessors, how many trainers do we produce, how many are we targeting, what is the ideal. Every year, and you can go back to the records of the Senate. So just for this particular issue, this particular topic that we are talking about, with the okay, 197,000 learners na lang itong which is 47% lower than the estimated target, how many assessors are we do we need to assess and certify these graduates, ma'am?
If we have to consider, Mr. Chair, so 197,077, then that will be around 10,000, 17,000 assessors.
So at least 10,000.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
So that's my point. We are only targeting 6,000 because I'm not pointing fingers, because that's our capacity, right? We cannot just draw numbers from anywhere. So the what we need is about 10,000, our only target. Our maximum target would be 6,000, probably. That's the main reason why we place that. And this is only for the senior high school graduates. We're not even talking about the entire TVET sector, those who are in need. And so, for example, let me ask this question. In a week, how many senior high school TVL graduates can actually be assessed in a week with our numbers right now? With our number of assessors available catering to our senior high school TVL graduates. How many? 10 a day? 10 students. 10 students a day per assessor. So you compute in a week, but how many assessors do we have? Specifically for SHS lang, TVL. So with that, my only point is that you can already aim to assess and certify by the end of 2024. Ito lang talaga. Diba? Ito lang talaga. Hindi mo pwedeng imbentuhin eh. And that's why I'm glad that it's a continuing appropriations. Magagamit pa rin. And as mentioned a while ago, we can look doon sa mga gumraduate na before na pa pwede nating i-assess. But again, I always, and I have been espousing this and advocating this particular issue of ensuring that we'll have enough assessors. And I hope that we really take it seriously. Thank you, Senator Witt.
Thank you. Senator Joel also inserted 50 million. Precisely to expand the assessors, no? Because during the last budget hearing, he was very emphatic about the assessors, no? So he managed to insert that 50 million. Is the 50 million enough?
You're very kind. You're the one who also pushed for it.
So, is the 50 million enough to accredit 10,000 assessors? Because that's really the 50 million is designed to increase the number of assessors, no? Because that was the problem before, and the Senate responded to that problem. Now it's up to the department to use the fund to solve the problem.
Mr. Chair, based on that provision on the expansion of the number of assessors, so we have considered the ones provided by DepEd. So the budget will be used into three components of that part. One is the training of the TVL teachers on the COC2 competency assessment certification of trainers methodology level 1. The second one is on the assessment fee, and the third one is on accreditation fee. Then based on the catch-up plans that are provided by the DepEd and also by our own provincial offices, the 6,025 is more or less enough. For the 6,025 targeted TVL teachers as prospective competence assessors is more than enough yung 50 million po for this year. But if we still to expand next year, then maybe that budget can be increased.
Sorry, but the 6,025 is only good for the 197,000 learners. Is that the correct statement? Or the entire targeted graduates of 418,000 for grade 12? A microphone, please.
Initially, Mr. Chair, that is for the... that is for the use of the 197,000 plus our existing assessors.
Sorry, just to clarify, Mr. Chair, no, the 50 million is really designed for approximately almost 10,000 assessors, yeah, which was the original estimate of what it would need if we were going to do the 400, almost 500,000 students. So obviously, since the number of students have gone down, in terms of expectations. And there is a desire from DepEd side to increase the 197 by trying to catch even the previous year's graduates. The 50 million right now, I think, is ready actually for download at any time, depending on DepEd telling us the schedule, you know, of where they want these assessments to occur. So yun ang next step po ng task force.
The 50 million will be downloaded to the test the provincial offices, and they will be the one training the assessors. The assessors will be DepEd personnel, okay, and they will be accredited to be assessors, okay.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
All right, and then for the
pwede. Yung assessors na yon for NC 1 and 2 lang, tama ba?
Not exactly.
Not exactly.
It depends.
Okay. Siguro hindi na lang kami ng breakdown kung anong plano doon, no?
Ano lang, sir, because the teachers generally are NC2 holders, right? But the assessment training can go beyond that naman.
The 438 million that will be targeting 197,000 students. That is for which school year? The 197. This
2023-2024, Mr. Chair. Okay.
And the balance now will be for for this school year, or for this coming school year?
Sorry, sir. The request of DepEd is that we take into account perhaps the students that graduated in 2022-2023. No, as a stopgap, but depending on where they are, obviously they may be difficult to find. To do that and make it part of the implementation in May and June for 2024-2025. So I do know that the NEP has an additional amount that is based upon this year's amount. So the prediction is that's going to be carried over as well.
Still target the students for school year 2024-2025. And how many are those students? 2024-2025. Do we have an estimate already? Meron na, okay. Sigalo, alam eh.
The grade 11 students now, sir, are at... Director Janet.
Thank you, Sec. Initially, Mr. Chair, we have considered the grades 11 students. So initially, we have a target of 201,914.
940. Okay. This is for grades 11.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
How about for grade 12?
We have yet to validate, Mr. Chair, okay, with a DepEd.
But it will cover grade 12?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Okay, so for, let me just make it clear. So for 2024-2025 school year, it will cover grades 11 and grades 12, of which grades 11 will have 201,000 students.
914. Okay. Yes, Mr. Chair.
Okay, thank you. Miss Janet, just submit to us a plan. I understand you're the team leader of the task force. Just submit to us a rollout plan of this program to include timetables and numbers so we can follow it as it's being implemented.
This is noted, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Wynn. You covered a lot of issues that I wanted to raise. Me try to look at my notes. Yun lang nung I think yung always a challenge for TESDA, syempre yung utilization of scholarship allocations. And I think the secretary, myself, and Senator Wynn had so much experience in both houses, both in the lower and the upper chamber, that a lot of legislators don't really understand the intricacies of the budget utilization of TESDA, no? Yung how you obligate and the disbursement. Sometimes they look at the disbursements, school year yan eh. Hindi yan talaga madi-disburse until such a time na matapos yun. No? So we're very much aware of that. So we just wanted to make sure that we have a clear catch-up plan, as stated a while ago by the good secretary, when it comes to a scholarship utilization program. Yung dito lang sa TWSP and the Tulong Trabaho Fund, you look at the disbursement to allocation rates, kaya mababa yan, no? 22% to and 51% respectively. I also believe because of that. Now, my question, perhaps my first question is, what changes to the process, if any, yung introduce po ng ating ahensya para dun sa disbursement of scholarships under the program of enterprise-based education and training framework, no? We feel na, I think EDCOM, wala na si Carl, they were very passionate about the inclusion of private institutions in rolling out the program together, of course, with the enterprises. So kasama po ba ito to encourage more establishments and trainees to participate in the enterprise-based education and training program?
Can I ask DDG Nelly to respond?
Thank you. DDG Nelly, you're recognized.
Ma'am. Okay, thank you very much. We're actually looking at it on a bigger perspective. First, looking at the partnership that we have right now, utilizing the number, because these are already resources that are available. I think there are more than 2,000 or more than 3,000 partners that we have right now. We're looking at the figures on how we can make use or consider them to become part of the industry training board. That's one. And being part of the industry training board could actually, you know, address some of the concerns that TESDA has right now in terms of development of competency standards, etc. And another thing, we also wanted to make use of the figures right now as far as partnership is concerned. And see how many among this number, or among these partners, can actually become part of the enterprise-based training. So yesterday, when we were looking at the figures, we have around 124, but this is yet to be cleaned, sanitized, because we wanted to make sure that, you know, these are actually potential institutions to become part of the enterprise-based training. But good to mention also, in the presentation of DG Kiko early on, recognizing also the possible inclusion of the non-TESDA government training programs, because I think they have training programs which may be eligible for program recognition. Just to mention, I actually come from a training institution of the DTI, and before that with the DOT, we have actually a number of training programs that are, offered, but these are non-TESDA. But in the discussions that we had with some of them, I think TESDA certification or TESDA certificate is actually adding value to what they already have. And another thing, again, looking at the figures that we have right now, there are a number of institutions that can already be considered IBACsable, that can be adapted and adapt. Just to mention a few of these companies, we have IBM, Google, Microsoft. These are authorities in themselves. So we're actually also looking at the process on how we can make the existing programs that they have to become a part of the IBACs. There's actually a process. And I think that will also contribute to the challenge right now on increasing the number of, NC3s and NC4, because as I was saying, they're actually leaders and authorities in the industry that they have. We have also made a list of the programs, but these are yet to be, of course, evaluated, endorsed by ITV, and evaluated by TESDA for consideration for program recognition.
Yes. Thank you. Secretary, please.
Yeah. So just to say, that obviously there are three things that we need to triangulate. Mr. Chair, the first is obviously the partnerships that we have with industry to maximize it so that we have apprenticeships, internships, dual tech, right? Enterprise-based training. But the enterprise-based training needs to also be linked, not necessarily anchored, but linked to the priority skills maps that are done in agreement with specific localities, with regions, and so on. The last piece that needs to be triangulated along those two things, along with those two things, is obviously the way we offer the menu of scholarships. Now, so the institutional frame by which TESDA tracks, whether it is institution-based, community-based, or enterprise-based, might need to find modalities to cut across all three if we are, in fact, to target it much more efficiently along specific sectors. So the skills map, for example, that the TESDA generates organically in many ways from the grassroots and in conjunction with both DTI and DOLE, gets to be translated to a priority skills maps around which, of course, the national qualifications map that is the basis for scholarship being offered needs to then be aligned. So marami hong internal housekeeping, kumbaga, in terms of our own processes to make sure that these three sets of initiatives go hand in hand as we move forward, which is part of the answer, Senator Wynn, to your earlier question of making sure that as we try to increase the enrollees, the enrollees are not just a shotgun approach, but directed to specific sectors with the highest impact, whether it be for local employment and industry growth and development, or one that simply has to do with the aspirations of our general population, whether that be local or international.
Thank you, Secretary. And we appreciate the statements made by our Secretary and the importance of looking at the menu of our scholarship programs. We feel that for quite some time we have been pounding on TESDA to concentrate on what's employable, sustainable, highly skilled programs, etc. And to point out what DDG Nelly made mention a while ago, we just passed here in the Senate third and final reading yung ETAP bill, this is the expanded tertiary education accreditation and equivalency accreditation program, and it's basically because we feel the importance of recognition to prior learning initiatives of the government. And tayo sa TESDA, we're competency-based. And I think we really need to pound on it. TESDA has a unique calling. Ang sabi ko nga lagi sa education sector, TESDA yung Holy Spirit eh. Dun sa Holy Trinity in the Christian world, mahirap intindihin yung banal na spirito, pero yun yung isa sa pinaka importante as a Christian, no. Let me just point out, no, dito sa GAA ng 2024, there's an allocation of 2 million pesos out of the 1 billion 35 million TTSF allocation, and this is to develop the guidelines which shall recognize micro-credentials and MOOCs as selected training programs under the Tulong Trabaho law that we pushed and authored. We'd like to find out from TESDA the status of the development of models and guidelines for the recognition of globally recognized courses na nag-o-offer po nitong micro-credentials and massive online open courses as selected training programs under TTSP. Yung guidelines po ba has been crafted? Where are we? Status po? And how will this be rolled out or operationalized?
Can I ask DDG Rose to respond?
DDG Rose, please.
We had a meeting po with Dr. Vea, Attorney Vea, Dr. Vea last week. And because of their experiences in Mapua on the development of micro-credentials and their partnership with the Arizona State University and Coursera. So he made an initial assessment po that our training regulations and competency standards in all its characteristics can be considered as micro-credentials. So we're moving towards that. We wanted him to really get into, to deep dive on this and really come up with policy guidelines together with TESDA so that when we can curate a more clearer and clearer guidelines and policies on this particular thing. In regard for the TESDA online program, since we will come up with a declaration that the competency standards through a policy paper and the TRs can be considered micro-credentials, so we could populate already the TOP by really providing all the TRs already as a
TOP is TESDA
online program. Sorry.
Training regulars. Maraming nanonood sa atin para.
TESDA online program so that yung mga TRs po and competency standards can be converted into programs na of the TESDA online program.
So, the guidelines are, still being crafted, right?
Yes po.
As we move forward. And may timeline tayo dito as to how long and timeline natin to roll this out and to be operationalized.
The policy paper po is we are committing to the secretary that it will be given, the first draft will be given to him by first week of October. So we are also in touch with the Aboitiz group so that we could be able to come up with a course builder. So it's easier for us to really create micro-credentials in different sectors. So the secretary had a meeting with the Aboitiz group of companies last week on this.
Okay, sige. We'll look forward to it. I'll give you the floor.
Related to that, Secretary DDG Rose, is we also saw and took note that the industry boards, out of the 12 industry boards and industrial groups, 12 out of the 67 have been created, constituted. No? So that's only 17% of the total. And moving into the enterprise-based training and all of this company-driven or industry-driven trainings, this is quite low in terms of constituting the board. So where are we in terms of achieving achieving organizing all of these boards, and what's the plan in terms of addressing this constitution of the boards?
Senator Win, just to first have a rejoinder for the record to what Chairman Villanueva said, no, the course builder is in the tier two request, no, that is being given to the Senate now. But in terms of, and so is in fact a allocation to increase the industry board's organizing. But I would like to ask DDG Nelly to respond in terms of where we are and what the proposals are moving forward to make sure that more industry boards and skill sector boards actually can get constituted and organized.
Thank you very much, DG Kiko. Okay, initially, or right now, we have a total of 4 or 5 industry boards coming from the printing industry, construction, tourism, IT, BPM. Okay, anyway, moving forward, we actually revisited the commitments TESDA has, because we actually have 10 sectors, priority sectors that we need to cover. We revisited in the sense that we wanted to find, we connected with them. Okay, moving forward, we engaged industry players, not only industry players, industry associations, but even government agencies that are supposed to support, you know, sectoral priorities. Like, for example, tourism will be for Department of Tourism, agriculture for DA, etc. But we also included training or learning institutions, because we're actually targeting the quadripartite, you know, policy that we wanted as far as this is concerned. Because I think each and every, you know, group in the quadripartite could actually contribute in what we wanted to happen. Like, for example, the industry association would be able to provide expertise, not only expertise, but also possible sources of trainers, maybe even assessors and even assessment center. Now, the government agencies can actually provide, you know, direction, policy direction, because this would fall under their sectors. And then the learning institutions can be utilized in terms of the development of, you know, the competency standards and all those, because these are actually something that they are already into. So those are actually the things that we're looking at right now. We did sign-ups. As of yesterday, we already have a total of 102. We already classified them into different sectors because we wanted to engage them in group. I mean, composed of the different 4 groups. Again, quadripartite, 4 groups. And we're now, you know, into the next phases, because I think that the important thing to do is for them to be capacitated as far as how to develop the different, how to develop competency standards, CAT, competency assessment tools, how to become trainer, how they will be qualified or become eligible as assessor, how to set up assessment center and all that. That's actually the next thing that we're doing, because we wanted them to already be engaged as far as what we wanted these industry training boards be doing or be supporting for TESDA. We hope to be able to complete the capacity building by October. Capacity building will actually be done by the different executive offices of the TESDA, as the PLO, which is actually under my portfolio, is the very entry point of the private sector coordination or partnership or participation.
See, boards are meant to, in simple terms, are meant to advise TESDA in specific industries. in terms of where the industry is going, what type of skills do they need. This is to be able to reduce the mismatch, so to speak. Diba? That's the goal.
Yes, actually, going through LMI, development of the COC, the TR,
right,
etc.
Right. So all of those, no? But yes. From a macro point of view, because the premise there is they know their industry better than us. No?
Yes,
so right. They will give us advice on where their industry is going. And then later on, no, macro micro activity, you'll develop the TRs and the other things.
Yes, yes.
So that's the general objective of the industry board. But since we only have 12, then we're not really looking at the different industries. No? For example, automotive industry. What are the top 10? You mentioned earlier the top 10 industry.
Okay, let me check.
Because I can see the wisdom and the benefit of these industry boards, because they know better than us. Eh. So what are the top 10?
Okay, we actually have ICT, construction, tourism, agriculture, manufacturing, creative industry.
Are these taken from the PSA? This is different. No? Because PSA, they have a classification standard.
Dole. Yeah.
This is from Dole.
These are also
part of the key employment generation sectors, if I'm not mistaken. Your Honor, Senator Wynn, I just would like to point out, since the day I became a human being, it's the same sectors that we have been talking about. It is actually exactly the same. And that's why we got to do something about it, not only with TESDA and Dole and the DTI. I think we have to really come up with something new, because it's exactly the same. Since the time I was in TESDA, I mean, it's almost a decade now. Perhaps if we can also parang compartmentalize and be more specific, particular industry, like in what particular IT sector are we talking about?
Granular,
yeah. I think, sige,
yes.
Please.
Actually, yes, talking about ITBPM, we're looking at it on a subsector basis. Like, for example, animation, yeah, game development, data analytics and AI, call center, contact center, of course, and health management information, something. Okay, but the okay, these are actually, I mean, priority as far as the ICT subsector is concerned is on those that already have Philippine Skills Framework. So, and for the creative industry, we're also looking at, you know, specifics. In the PSA, I think in the PSA presentation that was presented early on by DG Kiko, there were leather goods and shoes, furniture, yeah, visual arts, and a lot of those things. We're also looking at it on, you know, specific subsector under the creative industry, because I think we have a total of 7 pillars, but under each pillar would also fall a number of several subsectors, actually.
What's the plan? Right now, we only have 12 industry boards. So what's the goal for 2025? And is there a cost to creating a board?
Mm-hmm. Our target initially is to complete the 10 priority sectors. But that will not only be 10, because as you were also suggesting, we're looking at creating also industry Tibet board per subsector. So we're looking at, you know, more than 10, actually. Now, in terms of the cost, there's actually a cost. We requested for, I think, in the presentation early on, about 58 million. The cost will actually go to capacity building, because we're looking at a nationwide industry board. So bringing together experts, industry association, learning institutions, etc., to a particular sector or subsector, and capacitating them on how they can actually support the different programs, realizing the different programs of TESDA.
Board. To create one board, how much is the cost? More or less, just roughly.
So if it's 50.
But this is just to run and become. This is to run and manage the board, diba?
Yes.
But the members are they do they have honorarium or purely voluntary? Meron diya. Okay. Yeah. So there's a cost in creating an industry board. Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay. Mr. Chairman, I saw in the request also the study of embedding TVET in senior high school. I remember this was a proposal from the predecessor of Secretary Benitez, DG Magunadato, the former DG. It sounds interesting, but I remember telling him that this is a very technical aspect, and I'm not a technical person who can tell whether it's possible or not. It really needs a lot of specialists. And I would like to ask the good secretary, because I saw in the proposal that it's a small amount, no? About 3 million pesos. Nevertheless, is this a new direction that the department is taking in order to boost the competency of our senior high school graduates?
Mr. Chair, as you know, there is actually a order from the president to embed, right? So I believe that in the time of Secretary Mangundadato, this was partly the response in order to make sure that we do it appropriately and logically and rationally. The truth is the embedding of TVET in senior high school, the process of doing the embedment is actually going to be very similar to two other things. One is the generation of micro-credentials. And the second is the process by which recognition of prior learning might happen, not only towards DepEd, but also up towards college, right? So the key here is being able to extract learning outcomes that are present in the competency standards of TESDA and in the training regulations of TESDA, and see where in the curriculum, for example, of DepEd, they may lie or might be found. And then designing ways by which they can be assessed, either whether they're present or absent, or whether or not a assessment of gradation of skills or depth of training can be discovered. So to the extent that lifelong learning and micro-credential bundling, no, for multiple pathways is going to be part of what TESDA is going to move forward towards, this piece is one that will see how that kind of a framework, in fact, can take into account senior high school specifically. So to answer very quickly, there is a much larger framework that we're trying to develop, having to do with lifelong learning and multiple pathways, which will also require being able to curate and bundle micro-credentials, but be able to link that to specific learning outcomes aligned with PQF, skills framework, and so on and so forth. And this is a small slice of how we might imagine to do it rationally for senior high school specifically.
This is only a study, no? So we're going to undertake a study. Okay. But the potential, but based on your analysis, the potential is there, no? Yeah, okay. Because the way I understand it, for example, for ABM, for accounting, business and management, like the bookkeeping course, that can be embedded, no? Which sounds logical, no? And but again, no, whether it's possible or not, that's a technical question that I'll leave to the technical people to study. No? Yeah. And then going back to the certification, national certification for senior high school, Mr. Secretary, I noticed in the budget that was not requested for 2025. No, and I would assume. Ah, nasanep na siya. Okay. Sorry.
So, sir, the assumption is there's going to be some leftover from this year's budget.
Okay.
But there is actually also a budget within the NEP
Okay.
Therefore, no real need to request for an additional.
Okay. I stand corrected. Okay, I stand corrected. So there'll be the 400 plus in 20 for this year will be carried over partly, and then there's an additional 400 something, no, for 496 for 2025. All right. Thank you for that clarification. No more questions. No more questions, Mr. Chair. I'll just listen to your.
Thank you, Senator Win. As always, we learn from our chairperson of the EDCOM 2. And we thank him a lot for contributing to the development of our tech book programs for quite some time now. Let me ask this question on the scholarship allocations for RCEF and RESP and CFSP. I was looking at the data of the physical accomplishment. You have 40,000 enrolled in 20, for RESP, and CFSP 7,291. We have 50% of our graduates from RESP, 20,798, and for Coconut Farmers Scholarship Program, it's 5,378. Now, compared to the Rice Extension Scholarship Program, the Coconut Farmer Scholarship Program appears to be slower in terms of accomplishment. Are there any bottlenecks? Are we looking at some challenging problems that we are encountering in the implementation of this program?
If I may ask Director Ling to respond.
Director Lina, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Secretary. So for the Coconut Farmer Scholarship Program, po, sir, one of the main challenges is the identification of the coconut farmers, because they have to be registered under the National Coconut Farmers Registry System.
So you identified the beneficiaries by looking at the registry of DA ba? Ganun ba yun?
Of PCA, Mr. Chair.
PCA.
Yes, Mr. Chair. It's the NCFRS po. We actually raised this up with the PCA already, because the data in the regional PCA offices are not regularly updated dun sa national registry. So that's one of the bottlenecks. Second would be the availability of the farm schools offering yung programs po na gusto din ng farmers.
Okay, let's talk about the registry of farmer beneficiaries. May malaking difference ba yung RCEF, RESP, and the coconut farmer beneficiaries under the CFSP?
Yes.
May malaking difference?
Opo. Dun sa RICE, yung RSBSA, Rice Farmers na Registry po, this is maintained by the Department of Agriculture, and this also includes yung farm farmers, farm owners, and farm workers. So meron din pong I think may we na work out po na data sharing agreement with DA for that. So that's a separate registry po compared dun sa registry ng PCA for coconut farmers.
In your assessment, that has become a problem.
Yes, Mr.
Can we get na lang something from you guys so we can raise this in the budget of the Department of Agriculture so we can help out, no? But I remember last year, no less than our colleague Senator Loren Legarda asked that question. What if you encountered a walk-in farmer beneficiary? So what actions do TESDA take to ensure that they are still accommodated if they qualify for agricultural scholarship programs?
We have po direct link with the municipal agricultural officers, kasi sila po din yung merong registry nung sa RSBSA.
Not just with the Department of Agriculture.
Yes, po.
Okay. Sige. And there, what programs are the farmer beneficiaries trained?
For
are those covered by our training regulations? Hindi, ano?
Dun sa RSF po, Mr. Chair, we have agro-entrepreneurship, NC2 and NC3, and then the rice machinery operations, NC2. We also have operating rice mill machinery and equipment leading to rice machinery operations, NC2.
Sige, subukan natin. Itong RESP, you have a total graduates of 20,798. Estimate po dyan, ilan dyan yung gumraduate with or covered by our training regulations?
For...
ito na lang, itong nasa board niya na RESP.
Ang graduates po for...
O baka ibang figures na because this is only as of June 30, 2024.
We have po, Mr. Chair, as of August 25.
Okay na, let's just use your figures. So from the graduates of August, how many graduates?
Apo. This is from January to... August 25, 2024. So okay. That would be
August 2024. How many graduates?
4,725 po.
4,725. This is from CFSP or
From RSF po, Mr.
Chair. RSF. Okay. Out of the 4,725 na graduates, ilan po dyan yung covered ng ating training regulations?
Sorry, Mr. Chair. Ang total graduates is 38,365. Of the 38,365, 4,725 yung meron po tayong training regulation.
Out of the 38,000...
365.
So about 10-11%? Of our graduates are covered with the so 90% hindi po. But what about those covered by the certificate of competencies? Tying data.
Actually po, itong majority is from the production of high quality inbred rice, seed certification and farm mechanization.
Okay.
This was developed by the Department of Agriculture po, yung modules nito.
But this is part of our training regulation.
They have developed a competency standard based on the module of the DA. Recognized by TESDA. We also have po pest and nutrient management and digital agriculture course. Sige.
Just to expedite the process, can you just give me some of the problems and challenges that you're facing? Especially with the list, no? I just found out that there's a big difference pala between the registry of farmer beneficiaries under RSEF and CFSP. Para lang makatulong, mapadali po natin. Now, the every year I raise this issue on the unfilled positions in government. In fact, I started talking about this the very year I was elected as a member of this institution, and unfortunately, even until now, 1 out of 10 authorized positions in government are still unfilled. Now, if you look at TESDA as of September 2024, and just by looking at job orders and contract of service personnel, both technical and administrative in nature, TESDA has 2,488. However, if you look at TESDA's number of unfilled positions, ang nakalagay po dito sa report ay 915. You know, when I started advocating the issue of contract of service, job orders, nasa 400,000-500,000 lang eh. Ngayon sa buong Pilipinas, nasa 800,000 na. So, and you could just imagine my disappointment considering we have been espousing the rejection of endo contracts, no? Eh, pag tinignan mo pala, ang gobyerno ang number one violator. So, how can you encourage the private sector to follow suit if the government is the number one violator of ending endo. So I wanted to find out, no? First, perhaps my first question is yung unfilled positions po in TESDA. Ganito ho karami. May we know how do we assess these positions, particularly those that have been vacant for quite some time? I know the challenges, Your Honors, kasi for example, I remember when I was in TESDA, Secretary Kiko, there is this position for our legal position sa TESDA noon. I remember I only have one lawyer in TESDA. And may mga positions doon na hindi mag-fill upan kasi wala mag-a-apply. Ang baba-baba ng salary grade, you know? So I wanted to take the cudgels and raise this with other government agencies, especially with the DBM. Para, kasi kung matagal ng panahon itong unfilled positions, it's probably a problem na hindi na talaga mapifill upan yan dahil ang taas-taas nung hinihingi natin na trabaho dun sa isang tao na gusto nating bigyan ng napakaliit na sweldo. So I just wanted to bring this up again. And again, I've been bringing this up for quite some time now. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, if I may ask that Director Juliet be recognized to answer.
Yes, Director, you're recognized, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Secretary, sir. Mr. Chair, may I just have the latest vacancy in the agency, which we have on record for the 843 in total vacancy in the record of the DBM. That's not the 915 na, Mr. Chair.
843. Still big, okay.
Apo, 758 of that are the regular plantilla positions, which would go through the recruitment process of the agency. Okay. The others po that are present in the government manning are those CTI positions which are meant to be abolished.
Okay.
The CTO positions.
How many positions that?
58 po na CTI supposed okay. to be meant to be abolished, but okay. it is still in the system.
Okay.
There were CTO positions. The 26 vacant CTO positions, 9 of that, Mr. Chair, are supposed to be abolished because they belong to the former DDGs who were already separated from the service.
Okay.
Then may nag-a-appear pa rin pong isang coterminous to the appointee, which is a plantilla for a DDG, which po hindi naman po sa amin ang appointment, Mr. Chair. It's from the President. So, pero meron pa rin nakakount na isa.
Okay.
So in total po na idadaan lang po sa recruitment process namin ay 758, okay. Wherein po, Mr. Chair, breaking it down to the yearly po, because of the residual, we have new plantilla positions, a total of 748 items from 2019 to 2022. That's new plantilla, wherein yun po yung na ginagamit natin for career progression. Is promotions, which results to a residual vacancies. Then we have new plantilla items for the Cordillera State Institute. That's 2023 to 2024, 147 items. Bago po ito, which has to go...
How many is that?
147. They needed to have the reclassification of those item holders first before may open. So those are contributory to the number of the vacancy.
Sige. Say natin, no? Right now, you're talking about 58 plus 9, that's 67, that would be abolished, no? These items. And then you have 758 regular plantilla positions for recruitment. Hindi naman kagaya sa DepEd na pagka ng teacher, it will not take 6 months para dito sa plantilla positions to be... filled out.
Mr. Chair, may I respond?
Yeah, please.
Right now, I'm just going to have a reference for Mr. Chair for the 2021 beyond. Admittedly, we still have some positions in 2017 na vacant pa rin, which is yung guidance counselor. Meron pong nag-a-appear
since 2017 yan.
Apo, may isa pong 2017, may
because
isa pong
because the salary grade is how much? Hindi naman pa
SG11 and
SG13
apo.
So you already know why no one is applying.
Yes, Mr. Chair.
These are the items that I wanted to talk about. Can we figure it out? Kasi obviously since 2017 hanggang ngayon hindi na pipil up because no one would take that position. Wala nang bayani, maraming bayani yan, hasta kalibing na. Gusto kong malaman po yan, no? And isa pang gusto kong malaman, yung TESDA has, meron din siyang 355 unfilled plantilla positions for TVET trainers naman. Itong salary grade, gusto ko rin malaman, baka kaya rin walang nag-a-apply, no? But you have 318 job order regular faculty and 516 on-call job order trainers. We can show the table 5, please, ng TVET trainers in public institutions. So, gusto lang nating makita at paano natin itong mapupunan na director kung meron na tayong magagawa dito.
Yes po, Mr. Chair, based on our records, we the annual recruitment plan that we have, 745 po yung na-target natin for the annual recruitment plan for 2024. And we have already filled in the remaining for that is only 386 po, which ayun yung mga pinupunuan ng both central office, HRMD, which nagpa-process po ng SG18 and above. And SG17 and below po ay pinoprocess po nung lahat ng nasa regional offices. So the plantilla positions for the trainers includes po doon, ay included po doon sa pini... Apo, yun po yung continuous po tayo. Ngayon, okay.
Kasama na sa 758 itong 355.
Opo. Mr. Chair, it's also worth it to note that yung mga plantilla po kasi ng mga... trainers, like residuals. It would only reoccur also. The trainers also, kasi umaangat. And meron pong kasi mga plantilla items ng TESDA-administered schools that follows the NBC 461. When you call, and sa NBC 461 po kasi, when it is a reclassified position, kung baga, gained the qualification po to add the, to merit no, sa kanilang pag-akyat ng salary grade, it has to be collapsed. And when we need to collapse it, we need to request DBM para i-collapse siya sa original position before we can open it. So there were plantilla positions that were still pending with the DBM. We have requested
ilan po
them.
Yun? Ilan po yung nasa ganung stage out of the 758? Hindi, ganito na lang para mas mabilis. I-submit nyo na lang. Tell me your assessment and recommendations. Diba? Para I can make representations.
No, thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah, sige. Let me go to another issue which is been also my issue ever since yung number of assessors. No, kanina pinag-usapan natin yung sa senior high school. But may target na tayo. Medyo malinaw na. May target na tayo. Ilan yung po-produce natin, naponduhan na natin, etc. Now, let's talk about the bigger picture. The entire TVET sector. Here comes the bigger challenge. How many assessment centers and competency assessors do we have at present? Ano yung distribution niya para makita lang natin ulit. And again, taon-taon pinag-uusapan natin to every budget deliberation, assessment centers, assessors, saan sila distributed? Geographically, by sector, tapos lalagyan na natin ulit ng target. Diba? Taon-taon ginagawa naman natin ito eh. So, I just feel na taon-taon din lumalaki yung requirement at pahirap ng pahirap i-fill up yung ma-accomplish natin yung target natin. Sige, Secretary, please.
Janet, do you want to do the site certified? Otherwise, sir, it's in the... Yes. It's in the slide presented earlier. We have, as of 2024, according to the data I was given, 2,251 assessment centers, and we have 7,832 assessors.
Competency. 7,000. Sorry, the entire 7,000.
I'm sorry. I stand corrected.
Okay.
Yes. these are warm bodies, no? Count by institutions and warm bodies. Yes. You have 7,832 actual people.
832. There are actual assessors. And 2,251 centers. Of the 7,832 assessors, una, ito na yung universe, Your Honors.
Ito na yung sa DepEd lang ho, 10,000 ang kailangan per year.
Kaya nga, kanina, yun na yung sinabi natin sa senior high school. But you have 7,832. You have a target of producing 6,000 plus for senior high school, right? That's what I got kanina. That is for senior high school. What about for the entire? So, what's our, ano, Director Janet, can you help us out? 1,025 yung target for senior high school. Although the ideal is to about 10,000, no? But that's the target, 6,025.
Mr. Chair, with your permission, can I just give a short background for the... Because we have targeted based on two assumptions. So first is we have considered around 6,236,775 on average enrollees to be assessed by 2025. Average,
6 million?
Average lang po, Mr. Chair. Based on the enrollees we have received in 17 regions. So that's an average which may go to competency assessment for certification by 2025. So out of this 6,236,775, we have also computed how many assessment schedules to accommodate all the candidates, wherein one assessor is equivalent to 10 candidates in a day. So out of that, we have computed 623,677 competency assessment schedules. So that's on that was based on the computation that 10 candidates per qualification, per assessment center, and per day. So, however, Mr. Chair, we have also to consider that an assessment center can be accredited into multiple qualifications, and also the same with assessor. So that assessor can be accredited into multiple qualifications. So on that point. Assuming that an assessment center has been accredited on an average in at least two qualifications, and the same with the competency assessor, we have two assumptions on computing the possible the indicative target for 2025 in terms of the candidates. So we have noted that if first assumption is if there's only one competency assessor assessing 10 candidates with a total of 613,007, there is a requirement of 613,000. Yes, Mr. Chair. So if we have to compute that one competency assessor assessing 10 candidates, a total of 613,076 competency assessors is required to accommodate all the assessment candidates. On the second assumption is if a competency assessor is accredited on two qualifications, then we have a requirement of 301,238 competency assessors.
Okay. The first assumption is that we need 613,000. We only have 7,000 right now. The second assumption, which is... kind of ambitious, but still possible. We only need 301,000. So I don't know what how do we go from there? Because in the senior high school, taking the TVL track, we have 6,025 assessors target. Now, in the entire TVET, outside of the senior high school, ilan po yung target natin for next year? Do we have a practical? I already know the ideal, which is it's easier to turn wine into water to get 600,000 assessors, 613,000. Because you know, I'm a bit also not comfortable with the 6 million that's the average, diba? But still it's a big number. But then again, just to point that out again, how many assessors are we looking at? Are we targeting outside the SHS of 6,025? How many more are we targeting? Do we have that in our and we have the funding for that?
These are indicative targets, Mr. Chair, but we have still to validate further. But in your
we're here to help, and you know, at least nga yung SHS na nakita natin yung target, but the entire Tibet, hindi pa natin nakikita. It's been a real
ganito na lang challenge. Ganito na lang, sir. Let's assume that the targeting for the assessors for senior high school is accurate. So at around 200,000 students, we expect a minimum of around 6,000 assessors. So that's the ratio. If you assume that we will get a 1.7 million enrollees, then we work backwards in terms of the number of target of assessors using the same senior high school ratio.
And as we move forward in offering mga higher NCs, highly skilled training programs, then we also have to adjust, no? Kasi yan yung isang mabigat. So okay, we'll in Secretary Kiko, we trust.
48,000.
Oh, the target. So that's about 48,000.
That's more.
Yeah, it's more feasible than 613,000.
Yes. No, and sir, hindi naman ang rolling over naman yan, sir. Hindi ano eh. Hindi naman sila mamamatay the following year. So pwede pa rin silang mag-assess. No, so the number of students, assuming every year on average, we have to make sure we have a stable of around 50,000 assessors. Okay lang, Sen.
Thank you. Yes, of course. Kami pa dito, kami ang pinaka number one na tutulong sa TESDA. Itong twins dito sa Senate. Senator Reed, if you want to, please, anytime, please.
One more item I just saw on my notes is the number of graduates that undergo assessment for national certification. This is actually related to the question of our chairman. Only 52% or 5 out of 10 TVET graduates underwent competency assessment for the issuance of NC. This is probably related to the lack of assessors or other reasons? The last year was 64.3%, but this year it went down to 52%. No, so the there. So, and the target for 2025 is 60%. Is there any reason why our assessment is only 5 out of 10? And is this also related to the number of assessors that the chairman has been talking about for quite some time? Yeah.
Most likely, Mr. Chair, but with your indulgence, we need to think this through. I haven't been able to get a proper answer that makes logical sense. There are a lot of assumptions and a lot of conjecture, pero hindi pa ho namin nahihimay talaga kung bakit. But obviously, it's quite disturbing, to say the least.
Thank you. I just want to put that on the table, Mr. Mr. Chairman, and I trust that and I'm very confident that Secretary Benitez will take note of this and address this moving forward. Of course, the that my chain of thought here is we're giving scholarships, we're educating them. Hopefully, with the skills and knowledge that they get, they'll end up with good jobs, but they need to be certified at the end of the road. No? So,
Mr. Chair, just as a kind of proviso, no, the value of the certification actually, I think, falls on two levels. One is whether or not you need it for promotion, and the other is whether or not you need it to move from one corporation to another or to move from one sector to another. It is also possible that for those that undergo industry-based, for example, and or do not feel the need to be assessed, right? So if they're going to do an entrepreneurship program, they may not feel the need to get the certification itself, having undergone the training. But that is conjecture at this point and needs to be validated.
But just food for thought and thinking out loud. I'm not an expert like our testaman chairman here, no. But is the certification a necessary component to complete your training? For example, can, let's say, an accredited board, industry board, an accredited company or accredited entity, once accredited and maintains the standard, if that entity trains a student, trains a person, automatically that person becomes certified. No, so there's no bottleneck, so to speak, but there's a standard that the entity maintains in order to qualify the students that come out of their training. I'm just, again, I'm thinking out loud because the assessor seems to be a bottleneck. And every time I join the chairman to in his hearing, this always comes up. And it seems to me that it's very difficult to reach that, you know, that number, that number of assessors that we need. Maybe we can think of a standards-based qualification, something to that effect.
Before you answer, Secretary, I actually think that this is the I would love to think that this is the bread and butter of the agency when it comes to competency assessment and certification, because it sets the minimum standards of graduates that would pass the level of competencies where I wanted to recall right the exact words, that the candidate must possess the right knowledge, the right skills, and the right attitude before he or she can be certified. So just thought that this should not be the standard should be the integrity of this competency standard should not be compromised, and I think it's very important for the agency, the secretary.
So that is actually the issue on twofold, right? As DD Ginelli was trying to explain, particularly for certain types of industry partners, it's a little bit easier than others, right? So we're trying to come up with protocols and procedures to speed it up. But we must do so without compromising the integrity of the certificate at the end, right? So right now, the agency, I think, is exploring ways by which we can do those two things. And it still remains to be seen kasi ongoing pa rin yung first IBAC process namin sa ngayon. Sen. But obviously, that is part of the constraints, no? On the one hand, to ensure that minimum standards and quality assurance is met, while on the other, being as flexible as we possibly can, given that the experts are actually in industry and the needs of industry changes much faster than our capacity to respond.
Thank you, Secretary.
Well, that's the... I just want to put that on the table, and again, I have full confidence on the secretary that he is already looking at this, and I'm sure, very sure that we'll probably see some innovation in this front. And Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity.
Thank you, Senator Wynn. And otherwise, hindi na doduktorin yung mga NCs dun sa University of Recto. So, yun yung ano eh. Yun yung, it goes to show how we should take care of the integrity of the assessment and certification program of the agency. And we take pride of giving out these certifications, right? And that's how it is. When you see the students, the graduates getting this NC2, NC3 diploma courses, they take pride. So gone are the days that there's this penchant for diploma that or bachelor's degree courses. The only way to be successful in life is to have a bachelor's degree. So right now, makikita mo yung mga NCs nila naka-display sa bahay and they take pride. Just moving on, and I'd like to finish early. Actually, that's my desire. I was just looking at, can we show table 7? In 2023 and 2024, nakita ko lang po dito zero competency assessors in certain training regulations, chemical plastics, decorative crafts, footwear and leather goods, pyrotechnics. 2023, and as of July 2024, we have zero assessors. Wala na tayong naka-record dyan, or we don't really ano na ba, consider these sectors as relevant sectors at this point in time. Is this correct? Baka naman mali kami dito.
Director Janet?
Yes, Mr. Chair, those are the sum of the sectors wherein we have no qualifications yet. We have no assessors yet for certain qualifications.
If you say yet, you mean you're working on it, right?
Yes, so, Mr. Chair.
Okay, so it's not like we don't really pay too much attention to these industries or these particular training regulations. Sige, thank you. You know, I think Sec Kiko is also one of the authors and been advocating the importance of Philippine creative economy and industry. The economy is valued at 1.7 trillion pesos. This was in 2023. It contributes to about 7.1% of our country's gross domestic product. Now, if you look at TESDA and how you previously highlighted the creative economy as one of the drivers of job creation. May we know how is TESDA positioning itself for this particular sector? Because I'm just thinking out loud, baka may mga challenges tayo. Are we ready or we may not be well equipped in at present to contribute to furthering the growth of this sector? Baka meron tayong kailangan or tinitignang gawin? Your Honors, please.
Mr. Chair, as you can see from even the previous slide that you provided, particularly, for example, something like leather and footwear, right? Kulang ho tayo ng assessors. So one of the first things that we are doing, and as part of the, there's the budget proposal, no, to create the NCs and so on for the creative industries. The target is to find a way to reclassify in many ways some of the competencies and the NCs that we already have and the TRs that we already have, attach them to the Philippine skills framework that DTI has come up with, and then make them bump against the DOLE data, no, so that we can, again, as I said earlier, close the loop in terms of our data and our labor market intelligence, so that we can do a little bit more targeting. So there are certain drivers even for the creative economy that are already been identified as part of the Philippine Skills Framework, and DDG Nelly already talked about it. Game development, animation, and so on. There are already 21 TRs, no, that we can fall back on, and making sure that this is part of the scholarship menu and package moving forward. So, ang ano lang, sir, is reconfiguring what we have identifying the gaps of what we don't have and what we might need to create, and then making sure that we have the entirety of the ecosystem, including the assessors at the end. Now, and once we identify what those might be, it might be easier to find people that we can recognize and designate, you know, for whichever line that might be. So, for example, another one is very clearly within the creative economy, as you know, Mr. Chair, tangible heritage and handicrafts is a very major component, you know, for the Philippines. And the NCs have traditionally been in trade schools having to do with those kinds of skill sets, right? So beefing them up, strengthening them, and expanding them is certainly part of the plan.
Sige po, Secretary. No? And I also wanted to point out, no, not just itong creative economy, which is valued at 1.72 trillion. Itong digital economy was also valued at 2.05 trillion and contributed to 8.4% to the country's GDP. Yung kanina binanggit natin, 7.1% yung creative economy. So gusto rin natin maintindihan paano as a lawmaker, as a legislator, I'm sure the secretary would know this better as he is a former member of Congress. We wanted to understand and get as much as information that we can get as to the updates and the formulation of the digital technology and the digital skills roadmap. Paano natin na because under section of this act, section 6 of this act, kasama po ito, no, itong meron tayong participation dito. Kanina nabanggit that there are about 21 training regulations, no. When it comes to ito, itong digital technology and digital skills roadmap, it includes na itong artificial intelligence, no, cloud computing, other emerging areas. Oh, that's good to know. Sige, baka lang may gusto kayong
dagdag. Only to say that there is obviously a number of industry partners that we are leaning on, no, IBPAP being the biggest one, but also the Software Industry Association of the Philippines and so on. AI and cybersecurity, for example, are fairly major components of this. The difficulty is, in fact, of all of these different training regulations and NCs, the digital economy is probably the one that moves the fastest and changes the fastest. Right, so we are exploring and trying to find ways by which, in fact, the digital economy partners are going to be perhaps the first who will avail of the IBAC process that has just been set up. No, so tuhog-tuhog ho naman, there is actually a request from IBPAP to give them a certain percentage of support so that there is a critical mass in terms of their growth. They're growing without government support, right? But with government support, they hope to grow even bigger. So we're trying to find ways to ensure that at least in terms of the certification processes for TESDA, mapasok na sila so that even the Tulong Trabaho, for example, or the TWSP can be directed towards the kind of jobs and training that the sector requires.
That's why we fully trust your leadership, Secretary, because this is actually been a dream of ours for quite some time, and perhaps Senator Win, I will say this: for the past 6-8 years, if I'm not mistaken, this has been the most fruitful budget deliberation that we have encountered with TESDA, and that's why we're glad that you're at the helm of TESDA.
Chairman, so yeah, not because Secretary Kiko is here, no, but I support your statement. I join your statement that this is one of the most fruitful budget deliberations because it's forward-looking. We're leapfrogging into technology. We're leapfrogging into the 21st century and the demands of the 21st century. And we're recognizing that this type of skills are needed by our constituents and also need partnerships, for example, with ITBPM. Secretary Kiko, really, he hit the nail on the head. I collaborated with the ITBPM sector because of Create More when I was doing that bill. And they know the future. They know where to go. And, but they're also afraid because if we don't train our constituents, their constituents, their agents, and they're stuck with a normal calling and very mechanical jobs, we will be left behind with artificial intelligence. And I can see that myself. No, all of us who downloaded ChatGPT knows that artificial intelligence is not using your big computers, but using your phone. No? Your phone will now be equipped with artificial intelligence, and that's what we're competing against.
So, ano lang sir, twofold, just one comment and then maybe one request. The comment is actually to say that the window for that evolution is closing. No, as globally the configuration of the world of work is shifting, the IBPAP is very concerned, no, that the window is actually much more narrow than the country expects it to be. Along that line, we do note that the TESDA's official request is for a 10.6 billion scholarship addition. The Tulong Trabaho and the TWSP, that is about 6 billion here, papiranggot po actually ang nandyan na actually IBPAP request. IBPAP's request ranges from 2 to 3 billion a year for the next 3 to 4 years. Which has not yet been put in to this TESDA request. So kung gusto ho ninyo na mas directed, pwede po nating gawan ng special provision, no, ang GAA na maglagay that specific to this sector, no, you are willing to allocate in preparation for TESDA being able to certify and have quality assurance in terms of our IBAC process, for example, IBPAP centers to be both training agencies and assessment centers, as centers of excellence, right? And then commensurate government support for that. We can certainly send your offices, sir, the IBPAP proposal, no, to see whether or not that can be even added on top of this. Kasi doon pa lang, sir, sa scale na gusto nila, mauubos po ang TESDA. No, sa totoo lang. No, so, as a final word with regards to this topic.
Thank you, Secretary. And thank you, Senator Quinn. Perhaps before we adjourn this deliberation or budget briefing of TESDA, I will be remissing of my duty if I don't ask the preparations that been undertaken by the agency for hosting, because we're hosting the 14th ASEAN Skills. ASEAN. Yung World Skills, ito kakaano, but ASEAN yung i-host natin next year, no? And alam nyo ho, hindi lingid sa aking kaalaman as a former DG, ang preparation takes at least two, three years yan eh, no? If you're talking about equipment, you're talking about the venue and other administrative matters, and we previously talked about this a couple of weeks, if not a month ago. Ano po yung... I don't know. I didn't see anything in the proposed budget as to meron ba sa tier 2 sa request. Nasa request, wala pa sa NEP.
Meron po sa NEP.
Meron sa NEP.
Meron po sa NEP, but kulang po sa pangangailangan.
Yeah. So how are we preparing for the 14th ASEAN skills competition?
Mr. Chair, with your indulgence, I would like to request the recognition of DDG Vidal.
DDG Vidal, you're recognized, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Right now, Mr. Secretary, we are crafting the administrative order that will be proposed to be signed by the President to constitute the organization for the preparation of the ASEAN World Skills ASEAN Skills Competition. Aside from that, Mr. Chairman, we would like to propose to the Honorable Senator Villanueva that and the Chairman of the Education Commission that because of the very expensive rental for this event, we would like to propose for a construction of a permanent World Skills Philippines, Mr. Chairman, that will house all our innovations also, not only for these competitions, but for...
This is the 773 million rehabilitation of buildings 5 and 7 in the central office of TESDA. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
The only thing that concerns me is hindi naaabot to eh. If we're talking about a year preparation.
Mr. Chair, with the technology that we have now and as promised by our allies from the construction sector, they said, Mr. Chairman, and they promised that it can be done, Mr. Chair.
The scheduled skills competition will be on what month again?
August 19 to 25, 2025, Mr. Chairman.
They can move it up to October, but for a year to build the five, how many story buildings this?
Mr. Chair, this is his six-story building, Mr. Chair. Prefab na po ang gagamitin natin.
Ayan, pa kailangan makita ni Chairman ng EDCOM yan para mapondohan. Chairman, ayan po. Six-story building for a year. Oh my God. The equipment that we're talking about, hindi pa kasama pa dito yon, no?
Mr. Chair, some of the equipment nandyan na po nasama sa NEP, but of those equipments that we cannot afford, we have already forged partnerships with industries, Mr. Chair.
Sige, we'll coordinate. Let's keep our communications open how we can help. But if it is not possible to build a building in less than a year's time, a six-story building, siguro meron na din tayo dapat options are available for us. Sige.
But before I go, Mr. Chair, I would like to appeal kasi enshrined also to test the law, Mr. Chair, that there should always be a skills competition for all.
It would be beneficial. It would be... it would help TESDA. If the goal is to continue giving relevant training programs, hosting skills competition, yes, that's a long-term goal. But if we say that we will use this for next year's skills competition, baka marami tayong makaaway. No? Yun lang yung ating... iniisip. But then again, we'll do our best. No, we'll think about it. I'll share it with the members of the Senate. Yung wish list po ninyo. I was just appointed as the senior vice chair of this finance committee. Eh. So I don't know yet the direction of the mother committee as to how much the chairman of EDCOM would commit. Anyway, we'll look into this. Thank you.
Lastly, Mr. Chairman, with the indulgence of our beloved secretary, we just arrived last night, Mr. Chairman, from the World Skills International Competition that was held. Yes, Mr. Chairman. Our delegation of six contenders, Mr. Chairman, of that six competitors, Mr. Chairman, anim lang po yung afford nating dalhin doon, Mr. Chair.
Dala natin.
Of that six, Mr. Chairman, we got three medallion of excellence and one best of nation awards, Mr. Chair.
What's best of nation? That's the first time I heard about yung
pinakamataas na nakuha nating score, Mr. Chairman, among the participants. And not
among
all
the participants, but not gold, not silver, not bronze. So how could we say na highest?
Highest among the delegation from the Philippines.
Delegation ng Philippines.
So, yeah.
Anyway.
Yung 3 medallions of excellence, that's very commendable.
There,
it means you meet the standards.
Yes. Okay. And with that, Mr. Chairman, we ask...
Competent? How many trade disciplines yun?
Anim lang po ang...
No, anim lang yung napadala natin. Napadala but natin. Skills competition, ilan yun?
Right ilan now, Mr. Chairman, 68 skill area, Mr.
68.
Chair.
Anim lang yung na-participate natin. Dito sa darating na ASEAN, 14th Skills Competition, ilan yung...
We are preparing 35. For 35 skill area, Mr. Chair.
Siguro naman dahil host tayo, yung buong 35, mapifill up pa natin. Yun.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. And with that, Mr. Chairman, the delegates from the World Skills International, Leon France is also here to pay you a courtesy call, Mr. Chair, with the IDCOM Chair. Yeah. And of course, with TESDA Secretary. Nandyan po sila sa holding area po.
Let me congratulate in advance the Secretary of TESDA, Secretary Benitez, for giving us your clear direction on where TESDA is heading this coming 2025. I know that you've been appointed late in the game in 2024, so a lot of these things have been planned already. Nevertheless, I have full confidence that you will steer TESDA to much greater heights, especially attuned to what the world is heading to, especially in 21st century skills, technology, the world of artificial intelligence. And I can see that in your budget that you have already reflected where you want TESDA will go in the next few years. So congratulations in advance to the approval of your budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Wynn. I share the views and sentiments of our dear chairperson of the EDCOM 2. Thank you for all your support all these years, Your Honor, all these years. And we thank, of course, and congratulate Secretary Kiko Benitez. We are very happy that you are now TESDA kuya of all TESDANs. Of course, as always, we have been very cooperative and doing our best to help the agency. I always say this is my most beloved agency among all other government offices. And we'll do our best. We have heard a lot of challenges. There's so much that we need to do in order to best serve the best interests of our people, especially our mid-level workforce. And so again, thank you sa ating mga resource persons, sa family ng COA, sa DBM, mga executive directors, di ko na kayo iisa-isayin. Nakita ko pa si Elsie at si Jojo, nandito rin. Ating mga DDGs and of course, our delegates ng ating World Skills Competition. Congratulations. At marami daw kayong croissant na baon. Tsaka profiteroles, yun yung gusto ni Senator Wynn. But thank you. Thank you for representing our country. You are our pride. Maraming salamat. Especially dun sa tatlong Medal of Excellence. Congratulations po sa inyo. And so let me end by saying and declaring that the proposed fiscal year 2025 budget of the Technical Education and Skills Development Authority.
At sa naging isyung ito, ano ang iyong naging reaksyon?
maging malaya sa pagbibigay ng iyong personal na opinion sa comment section. Kung hindi ka pa nakapag-subscribe, aba, subscribe na para lagi kang updated sa mga maiinit na balita at talakayan. Salamat sa panonood at magkita-kita tayo sa susunod na video.